Good evening. That's better. And welcome to the evening session. This session is going to look at when East meets West. As you know, that's been one of the major developments in the 20th century, is the coming over into America and European countries of forms of prayer that were previously associated largely with Asia, India, those parts of the world, China, Asia. And so what does this mean for us in our Christian practice, in our Christian living? What does it mean for those who are in the journey of prayer? Is there something we can learn from the East? Is it something we ought to avoid? Those are questions that certainly people like myself who work in retreat centers have to contend with all the time. We find, for example, in retreat centers throughout the country, offerings in Zen, offerings in yoga. These are in Catholic retreat centers, and we have to ask ourselves as a staff, is this something we want to do or not to do? Many questions come up. Many issues come out onto the table, and they're not always easy to talk through. Anyway, we have this evening a person who has himself wrestled with these issues and will lead us in a reflection on them, Jim Arraj. Jim has written, as you know, on Jungian psychology and Christian spirituality, examining what Jung psychology can contribute, examining where it can't perhaps contribute anything. He's done the same with the East. He's done the same kind of analysis on Eastern forms of prayer, spirituality. And so without further ado, I'm going to let Jim take it from here and answer all those kinds of questions that we have to wrestle with retreat centers, and maybe many of you also in your own life of prayer and living. Jim?
Well, I give you all credit for being here tonight after the week you put in. That shows real courage. And the synapses are about to, you know, fry if we keep this up. But okay, so we're here. Now, the first night, Monday night, when I talked to some of you, we were talking about this emergent Christian spirituality that had various dimensions and pieces of which were already appearing, already being practiced. We talked about how Christian spirituality is here, and then we have, say, psychology like Jung's psychology, and then we have Eastern forms of prayer or meditations of the earth and ecology. Okay, and then in each area, there's challenges. Now, on Tuesday, we took up the challenge posed by Jung psychology and sort of came up with the conclusion that it's sort of like this. Here's the Jungian journey, here's the Christian journey. They are interpenetrated, they're interpenetrating, and they both are, people are trying to live out both of them. And if we distinguish them, we're going to be able to unite them. If we don't carefully distinguish them, one may gobble up the other. Okay, so that's where we've been. Now, where we're going is to do the same thing when it comes to the question of the East. And in the East, there's so many different currents. We could do it with Tibetan Buddhism, or we could do with Taoist yoga, or whatever. But I know more, a little more about Zen, so we'll do it, we'll try it with Zen. And we're gonna face the same thing, a tremendously exciting thing happening. It's like two spiritual galaxies are They're not colliding. Galaxies rarely collide because there's still a lot of space, but they're intersecting. And this intersection is probably one of the most important things that's happened to Christianity in centuries. Okay, but at the same time, no matter how exciting it is and how enthusiastic we get, we face a challenge of how we're going to bring it together. And we'll get to that challenge in a minute. First, we have to do something else to get it started on the right foot. If someone came up to one of us, any one of us, and said, well, I want to go on the Christian journey. And you say, oh, well, that's really nice. That's good. You're going to go on a Christian journey. And then they say, but I don't want to pray. Okay? Then where are we at? How can you go on the Christian journey if you don't pray? I mean, you're going to stand sort of outside it. And you're not really going to understand it unless you practice it. That's the way it is. Now, the other spiritual journeys are the same. So if someone came to a Zen master and said, well, I really would like to understand Zen, or I want to make Zen part of my life, but I don't want to sit, he would sort of roll his eyes. Well, he has more control of that than that, I guess, but it's the same problem. If we want to understand what Zen Buddhism is like, we have to sit, okay? I'm not saying that we have to practice certain devotional aspects that go together with Zen Buddhism, but the heart of Zen Buddhism is Zazen. Without Zazen, no Zen Buddhism. That's about it. Okay, so I think we should start by sitting. Now, we're not going to sit long, but you may find that after we've overtaxed this, the discursive mind, Zen people call it the monkey mind, well, after we've overtaxed this mind trying to understand everybody during the course of these days, it might be even restful to kind of, I can't say really turn this mind off. We don't have that much control over it. But picture it as like the waves on top of the ocean. We're always moving, we're always going. The mind is always flitting here and thinking this, and we can't just say, okay, blank, turn the off button. But what we can do is try to quiet this mind and sort of get away from it and get a more objective view of it, and more importantly, realize that we ought to fathom. And it's to fathom those depths of the self, or in the case of the Zen Buddhist, they wouldn't say the self, they'd say the non-self, the non-ego, the no-self. All right, so what we're gonna have to do is sit. Now, I'm not gonna make you sit a long time, so don't worry. How many of you have ever done any Zen-type sitting before? Okay, well, that's some. So almost half of us have tried it, so it won't be any shock to the system. And the rest of us, it's not that complicated to start. And it'll give us a little sense that these questions we're talking about really should be answered sort of by practicing both traditions. Not just knowing about them, that's important too, but practicing. So let's do a little Zen practice, and then we'll start talking about it.
Now, if you were to go to
and so forth, but and Westerners do it, especially at the beginning, because they can't twist up their legs, and the reason that the Zen people use that like half lotus or lotus or just crossed leg posture is because they found that it helps quiet the mind. Okay, so I'm going to take this thing off. I think you'll still be able to hear me. And what I want to do What I want to do is I'll sit here and I'm going to tell you how to sit there and then we'll go on from there. Now, one of the things they advise the Zen students to do is to straighten their spines. They don't want anybody bent over. They want the spine straight. Okay, so let's just sort of sit up straight. And if you have things in your hands that you can put down, put them down. If you can't put it down, well, sort of hold it still. Okay, now, so the posture is straight, and the Zen people usually leave their eyes open, but for a lot of us who have gotten used to praying with our eyes closed, it's all right to close it as well. They don't get upset about that. It's not a big thing. The hands usually go in the lap. The important thing is what we do with our breath after we take the posture, and more important, what we do with our mind. So instead of breathing here, like sometimes we do, though our breath is up here, we really want to breathe here, down in the stomach. So if we're breathing in, our stomach expands. If you put your hand there, try it, put your hand on this part and breathe in and try to see your stomach go out. And then go in when you exhale. That gives a different center of gravity. We don't want our center of gravity to be up here. We want it to descend and be down here, down near the solar plexus, down near what the Zen people call the hara point. Okay, so let's imagine the waves are here and all the turmoil, and we're going to take a little journey, and we are going to put our mind down here, sort of near our hands, or near our solar plexus. And I want you to try to sense the kind of depths that exist in us, because it's out of those depths that comes the awakening that the Zen people are so earnestly striving for. So try to breathe from the abdomen, but let your mind go away from all this turmoil, all these words, and go down to the stomach. Okay, let's do that for a little while. Now keep your attention down there in those depths. And because those depths are the depths that Christian contemplatives travel into, these depths of the soul. And while you have your attention there, I want to read you something. And this is a poem about those should appear in those depths for the Christian mystic. It's a poem by John of the Cross. So stay down there and listen to this. En una noche oscura, upon a gloomy night, with all my cares to loving ardors flushed, O venture of delight, with nobody in sight, I went abroad when all my house was hushed. In safety, in disguise, in darkness up the secret stair I crept. Oh, happy enterprise, concealed from other eyes, when all my house at length in silence slept. Upon that lucky night, in secrecy, inscrutable to sight,
I went without discerning, and with no other light except for that which in my heart was burning. It lit and led me through, more certain than the light of noonday clear, to where one waited near, whose presence well I knew. There where no other presence may appear. O night that was my guide, O darkness dearer than the morning's pride, O night that joined the lover to the beloved bride, transfiguring them each into the other. Within my flowering breast, which only for himself entire I save, he sank into his rest, and all my gifts I gave, lulled by the airs with which the cedars wave. Over the ramparts fanned, while the fresh wind was fluttering his tresses, with his serenest hand, my neck he wounded, and suspended every sense with its caresses. Lost to myself I stayed, my face upon my lover having laid, from all endeavor ceasing, and all my cares releasing. Threw them amongst the lilies, there to fade. Let's just slowly come back up.
It's a fairly well-known fact that many Zen students are Catholics and used to be Catholics and so forth. And many are Christians, and I think one of the reasons may be that so often we have lost our way to those depths, and in our own tradition, and so we turn to the East to find it, because we have a hunger to go down in those depths and explore them. And so we turn to Zen, and Zen spends its time trying to go down and explore those depths. Okay, now, the real issue that is going to come up soon and tomorrow over and over again is just how do these journeys intersect, okay? Are they the same thing? Are we there are profound analogies here, because we're leaving the ego behind and we're going down in these depths, and we're reaching for some sort of absolute. But at the same time, we have to ask the question and say, are these really the same thing? Are we aiming at the same thing? Is what St. John of the Cross said in that poem what the Zen people would say? Okay, there's no escaping that. And the more we get into this issue, the more critical that problem's going to be. The more we practice both paths, the more critical that problem's going to be. Zen people have their poets too. I'm going to read you a couple of Zen poems. First one's from Bunan. The moon's the same old moon, the flowers exactly as they were, yet I've become the thingness of all the things I see. That is a very powerful Zen poem. And a Zen, an awakened Zen person would really get off on that poem. Okay, I'm going to read you another little poem. It's Master Fuman's death poem. Traditionally, some of the Zen masters would write a poem before they died, sort of their last will and testament. Magnificent, magnificent. No one knows the final word. The ocean beds aflame. Out of the void leap wooden lambs. You get that? That's what the Zen master would say. Do you understand that? Can you show me those wooden lambs leaping out of the void? Well, are we dealing with some kind of, you know, mystification? No. There is something here that has energized people for thousands of years, and so that they would devote their lives to it. They have a monastic tradition just like our own, where people will devote themselves to search for the wooden lambs. Okay? I'll tell you one more. It's not a poem, it's just one of the sayings that ended up being a koan, like one of these things that the Zen students meditate on. And it's about a famous Chinese Zen master named Joshu. And monk came to Joshu, who was a great teacher, and he said, why did Bodhidharma come from the West? Now, you have to understand a little bit of the background. Bodhidharma was the Zen teacher who came from India to China and planted Zen in China according to Zen traditions. So he's coming from the West. So it means sort of, why did he come from the West? Sort of, what's the meaning of Buddhism, they could have said. What's the meaning of the Dharma? And Joshu looked at the monk and he saw that the monk was here asking questions and wanting conceptual answers. And he said, the cypress tree in the garden. That's the answer he gave. Okay? If the monk had been ready, that would have been enough answer to tell him what the essence of Buddhism was. Boy, what kind of sense does that make? You know, we're pretty much into thinking it over and saying, well, you know, what does this mean? What does that mean? I'm going to think out this. So we're in another world, okay? And that's why I say if we don't practice, we can't penetrate that world because you can't do it here. You can sit all day and say, cypress tree in the garden, thinking about it, why would he pick a cypress tree and where was the garden, and you know, could he said something else, and we'd never get anywhere until we exhaust this kind of conceptual thinking about things. And we get away from this and we get down here, away from all this conceptual thought. Okay. Now, we could say, well, you know, this sounds, this is pretty esoteric and it's not going to affect me because I'm a Christian and, you know, but sometimes, personally, we may not be called to go on any sort of Zen journey and, you know, we have different callings. But for the Catholic Church, it's not as if this intersection is going to happen. No, it's happening now. And that's what I want to talk to you about next. We're going to take a look at a few of the specifics. So we'll get to be a little Western here and draw some diagrams instead of Zen sayings. I'm talking about how we are, Zen is coming into the Catholic Church, has come into the Catholic Church. Okay, let's see if we can get this working here. Let's see, I'm gonna see if I can do it some
Can you just move the machine over there?
Yeah, sure. That's a good plan. I never would have thought. I'm honest, I wouldn't have. Okay. Alright. A little crooked, but you can see it all. Almost all anyway. Well, we'll get them all. There we go. All right. So let's talk about this. What does this little picture mean? Well, the story starts in somewhere around the year 1870 in Japan. And there's a little baby born called Sogaku Harada. That's Harada up at the top. And Harada becomes a Zen monk. He becomes a Soto Zen monk. Now, there's different schools in Zen, but simply put, the Soto monks are one sect. The Rinzai monks are the ones you hear about because they're the ones who use these koans, like Joshu's cypress tree. But there's Soto monks who have other ways of going about it. Anyway, he's a Soto monk. And as he goes on and gets older and he gets in his 30s, and he says, well, I'm not enlightened. I don't have it. I know all about Buddhism, but I haven't experienced Buddhism. So he finds an enlightened Zen master, a Rinzai Zen master, and he works and he becomes awakened. And so he takes what he thinks are the best parts of the Soto Zen tradition and the Rinzai Zen tradition, and he puts them together. And he was a monk. He never married. Some of the Zen priests marry, but he never married, and he had a monastery, and it was called Hoshinji, and it was he had intensive practice there. They would have these sessions, these like retreats, but in these retreats you would sit maybe 6 hours a day, okay, sitting in zazen, and you would be people may be silent, or they may be bellowing at the top of their voice their particular koan, which is often called moo. And so you'd have people going moo as loud as they can, trying to get it, trying to understand. That was another one of Joshu's puzzles. Monk asked Joshu, does a dog have Buddha nature? And Joshu says, moo, and which means not. And, you know, the monk goes away and says, well, I thought everything had Buddha nature, and why doesn't dogs? See, but the answer is not, according to the Zen thing, the answer is not something you're going to think about and say, oh, I'm going to think out why the dog doesn't have Buddha nature. He could have said yes. Or he could have said the cypress tree in the garden. Because it's not conceptual. Okay, well, anyway, there's Harada Roshi, Harada the Zen master, and they're bellowing moo, and what he's doing is making sure that Zen transmission goes on, okay? The Zen people like to think that from the time of the historical Buddha, Shakyamuni Buddha, the historical Buddha in India, to now, there has been a transmission, not just of words, like here's what the Buddha said, here's the sutras, but from mind to mind, that you got it, you pass it on and make sure your student has it, really understands it, not just can parrot it, okay? So Harada Roshi gets the Dhamma from his teacher, and he receives the kind of confirmation. It's sort of like the seal of approval, saying, now you're ready to teach. And so he's teaching. And since he is so dedicated, he begins to have many successors of his own. And so his successors are spreading around Japan. So if he, let's say, when did this happen? I'm not sure exactly, but he was about 40 when he finished his own training. And so you figure, you know, say in the 1930s, that was a time when he was really going pretty strong. And he lived to be, I think, about 90 or so. He died in 1961. When he died, he said, this was his final epitaph they put by some calligraphy that said, traditional Zen saying again, said, 40 years I've been selling water by the river. Ho, ho, ho. Okay? All right. Okay, so Harada Roshi has many students. One of them is Yasutani, okay? And Yasutani is a Zen priest, but he's married, he has a bunch of kids, he can't find a temple, so that would support him, so he works as a school teacher, grade school teacher. And finally, he finds his way to Harada Roshi, and he really gets it, okay? And when he gets it, so the Dhamma is passed on to Yasutani. So Yasutani is going around. Now, that's his big responsibility. How can I pass it on and to the next group of people? And so you see a little Zen monk running around Tokyo in his sneakers and in some tattered robe, and he's an enlightened Buddha. He has gotten the message, okay? All right, well, Yasutani had now we're getting after the war, World War II, and Yasutani has some, he has an American student. American businessman is fed up with the rat race, being an executive. He leaves everything. He goes to Japan. He's determined to seek enlightenment. Finally, after a big struggle, studying with Harada and going to the tough course, because Harada Roshi was a tough guy. He was determined that if you had it in you, he's going to get it out of you. Then he's studying with Yasutani. Finally, he gets it. And this person is Philip Kaplow. And he went and came to the States, back to the States, and he set up a Zen monastery. It was in New York, upstate New York. He also wrote a book called The Three Pillars of Zen, which is one of the best ways to get a sense of what Zen is about, because it talks about actual practice and people trying to get enlightenment, people having talking to the master, people actually getting enlightened, actual enlightenment accounts. So for those of you who are interested in that, that's a really good place to start. Okay, well, Yasutani also had a student called Yamada, Koun Yamada. And Yamada was one of his Japanese students who got the transmission. And Yamada, in turn, passed it on. But this time, we're getting later, and we have Catholics in Japan who want, going to Japan, living in Japan, who want to really understand Zen Buddhism, are willing to really work at it. And of these people here, Ruben Abito, Willigus Jaeger, Amasami, and the end is Hugo LaSalle, I cut him off here. All those people are Catholic priests, okay? Who became Yamada Roshi's students and received the transmission from him. So there are Zen teachers. Hugo LaSalle just died a little while ago. But they're officially part of the Zen lineage. They're kind of plugged into Zen. So the transmission, and this is the critical thing, the transmission has gone from Zen Buddhists transmitting to Zen Buddhists to transmitting to Catholics practicing Zen Buddhism. A tremendous quantum leap that we really don't pay enough attention to. Robert Aitken is another student of Yamada, and he in turn had a student, Patrick Hawk, who is in the States, US Catholic priest, who is another Zen Roshi. So another, it's going on. Now, these people are not sitting around on their hands, they are going around all over. People are coming to them, they are teaching people Zazen, how to practice Zazen. Okay, so, that's what I meant when I said the Catholic Church is seriously already involved in Zen, okay? In the person of these people, and there's others as well. Okay, but this sort of illustrates what is going on. Okay, so it's not like we can, as a church, say, well, you know, cute, but let's put it away. It's happening to us. And we're not going to escape it as a community. Okay, well, I find that very exciting and exhilarating because there is so much riches in the East, so many spiritual riches, and we can use them, we can need them, they can feed us, all right? It's sort of like when Buddhism was in India and died out there after a while, pretty much, part of it went to China. We talked about Bodhidharma. Part of it went up into Tibet. And the Buddhism that went up into Tibet was had its own distinctive character. And it was a Buddhism that not only retain the idea of sitting in the half lotus and breathing, but it retained much of a whole yoga tradition. So there's a Tibetan Buddhist yoga, okay, which is also fascinating. So what I'm saying is that there's this, somewhere, if I'm right, around the 3rd century in India, Buddhism was still there, and they had a famous university called Nalanda, and all the people were studying Buddhism. And from there, a lot of the wisdom that was in India in the Buddhist tradition went to Tibet, and it was saved in Tibet over these centuries with these sages and these monks, either in giant monasteries or up in these hermitages and caves spending literally years to penetrate the substance of this spiritual tradition. Okay, now, you know, once the Chinese invaded Tibet, then the flood of Tibetan wisdom began to enter the West. And we are the beneficiaries of that sad tragedy that is still going on. Okay, so here's our problem again. We have this wonderful thing happening. This wisdom of the East is coming and it's flooding around us, and it is attracting us and many of our fellow Christians. And well, what is the problem then? Well, that's good. Well, we got it together. We got everything now. Well, and life just isn't that isn't that simple, okay? Unfortunately, it's just not that simple. And like we face with Jung's psychology, there's a challenge we have to overcome if we are going to integrate these two spiritual paths. Now, I wouldn't want you to think that, you know, I went out on a pretty good limb on the Jungians saying what I thought the problem was and everything, but I'd like to sort of talk about the problem through some comments by people who are in a different and more authoritative position to see. Okay, the first person I'd like to talk about is a fellow named David Loy, who is in Japan now, but he is one of Yamada's students, you know, transmission, okay? And so he got interested in Christian mysticism, and he's certainly aware of Yamada's Catholic students, and he started reading The Cloud of Unknowing, and, you know, he decided to send a questionnaire out. He said, well, I'm going to send a questionnaire out to Yamada's Catholic students and ask them some things. This would be really cool. Well, it would have been cool, except that most of them didn't answer. You know, maybe that's Zen-like too, but some did, okay? A few did. And I think about four people answered, okay? So it's not a big sample to base it on, but his comments are, I think, important. And he found two groups there, two different tendencies. Some wanted to maintain a strong distinction between Zen practice and Christian practice. Okay, so we got this kind of, all right, here's the two hands kind of thing, you know, the Zen practice and this Christian practice, okay. And then there were those who see them aiming at the same thing and therefore to be eventually united. And it seemed to Loy that they meant mostly Zen practice with Christian terminology. Okay? There's the problem. Which is it? Are we talking about two spiritual journeys? Are we talking about one spiritual journey? If the Roshis can't tell us, we have to say, why not? Okay, what's happening? It means it's a real issue. And it may not be an issue that at this particular day you're going to have them jumping up and down about, otherwise they probably would have answered Loy's questionnaire, but you can't avoid that kind of problem. You know, you don't even have to talk about it, because sooner or later it's going to come and get you. All right, so what I'm saying is it's going to come and it's getting us. We have to know this, and it's hard, so hard to know, and we're back in the position we were with Jung's psychology, saying, oh my goodness, how are we going to figure this out? Okay. Now, you could wonder that what Yamada thought of having all these Catholic priests as students, you know? And he recently died as well. And he must have been a very exceptional man, because I can't imagine that he wouldn't have had people from the Zen Buddhist side saying, why are you messing around with these Christians? What do they have to do? They're just gonna mess things up here. Must have been a very exceptional man to receive these Christians and give himself to them and give the most precious thing that he had, and he did it, even though they weren't his, okay? And then he made them his in the most intimate way he knew how, okay? Transmission of the mind. Okay, so what did Yamada think about all this? Well, we have a way of finding out, because one time, after this was going on and his Catholic students were actually getting over the hurdles of Zen and becoming accomplished Zen teachers, he sat down with Ruben Abito and with Hugo LaSalle, and he said, well, I want to talk to you. And Ruben Abito gives us an account of what happened. I'm going to read that to you. Here's Yamada Roshi talking. He says, there are some questions I would like to ask Christians who come to me for direction in Zen. I have been wanting to ask these questions for a long time now, but I have kept them to myself, as I felt these may just confuse Christians as they begin their Zen practice. But I feel confident I can ask both of you now. Okay, now here's the questions. What would a Zen master think of all this? Okay? First, why did you not just continue doing meditational practices following your own Christian tradition instead of coming to Zen? Was there something lacking in Christianity that led you to seek something in Zen? Or did you have some dissatisfaction with Christianity that led you to Zen? Now, these questions are, we have to realize, this is a man who devoted years of his life giving to these students. You can see how reticent he was, because he, you know, must have had a great spiritual delicacy to, you know. Okay, now he's finally asking. Okay. Then he goes on. Those are kind of the general questions. Then he says, and also a question to Christians who have had the Zen experience through the Mu Koan, and which means simply that they have started getting awakened. They got over the first hurdle, the big first hurdle. How would you express this experience in your own Christian terms? And a third question. For those who have had the Mu experience, there is given the koan about the origin of Mu. How would you answer a question about the origin of God? Those are good questions. Those are our questions. We really have to say, what can Christians say about Zen enlightenment? That's what we're going to do. We're going to take, for those of you who make it tomorrow, we're going to talk about Zen. We're going to talk about Christian wisdom, different kinds of Christian wisdom, and we're finally going to go way out on a limb and try to describe what Zen enlightenment is from a Christian point of view. Okay? Okay. All right, so that's the agenda. We're setting the stage for that now. Now, there's so much we could
we could talk about in terms of what is Zen, and we'll do some of that. And I brought a really wonderful Zen teacher with me in my pocket again, lady Zen priest who has begun to awaken her mind and is going to tell us how she went about it. Really beautiful story. And I'm going to show some of that tomorrow. And I'm also going to show something about a Christian who received contemplative graces, the kind that John of the Cross talks about in terms of infused contemplation. I want to talk, we're going to meet him as well, because that's part of the context, okay? If we listen to these two people, maybe we'll get a clue of what's happening. Are they saying the same thing? Because these people are not theoreticians, they're practitioners, and they both have had deep experiences. So that's one way we're going to try to get at it. Okay. Now, I'm going to do something else, and if you remember our diagram, oh, okay, now I've gone on and on. I told you at the beginning, I thought I didn't get to talk more than 5 minutes, and I guess you're conditioning me to talk a lot more. I'm going to stop here a minute, and I'm going to entertain any questions or comments that you have, okay? You get the picture. This is the question. So tell me what you know about Zen in relationship to Christianity, and tell me what kind of questions arise from what I've been saying. Yes. And some of the hierarchical circles, they issued a letter that the Father here just reminded me of, and a letter to the bishops in the U.S. that ruffled a lot of feathers just a little while ago about, you know, Eastern practices in the Catholic Church. So obviously people have different opinions, and I think it's going to be the same thing we've been dealing with in the sense of Jung psychology. There's going to be the let's keep this away from us, and the other people are going to say this is it, this is the way to go on the Christian journey, and we've been stymied and now we found the answer. So you're going to have that whole spectrum again. And we're going to have to muddle through to try to figure out if there's some way to reach that integration. Okay, now, we're talking about Zen. And one of the problems in a Zen-Christian dialogue is that when we talk about Zen, well, the Zen people know what Zen is. The enlightened Zen master knows what Zen is, and he will go to a meeting in Kyoto somewhere and with the Christians, and he will tell them of how he was awakened when he saw the cherry blossom fall off the branch. Okay? Now, what are Christians going to tell the Zen master about what happened to them? Okay? Now, I think Bernadette Roberts would fare better because she's talking about experiences. Okay? But oftentimes, Christians aren't sure what they should bring out of their tradition to confront Zen with. Is it the monastic tradition? Is it the Christian mystical tradition? Is it some kind of something else? Okay? Well, to me, that points up to the problem that we're really, on the Christian side, just beginning to get some ideas of what to do. And I see that one of the indispensable steps in this Zen-Christian dialogue is for Christians to go to their own tradition and try to gain a deeper understanding of it so they know what they're talking about. We need to know what we're talking about. If we think we are experts in our own tradition, and there's some reason because we've lived it for so many years and we've lived it almost professionally, many of us,
for so long, yet we still have to undergo this kind of interior turning to our tradition and try to penetrate the wisdom of our tradition. So what we're going to have to do is talk about John of the Cross. That's one way I try to get at the Christian mystical tradition. But there's something else, and this something else I don't think many people are going to like. In fact, there's another part of our tradition that nobody wants to talk about in relationship to Zen Buddhism. And that is the metaphysics of Thomas Aquinas. Why? Because everybody, well, you know, I'm not speaking for you, but I have had the experience that for many of us, such a thing seems so conceptual, so dead, so much of that scholastic past we want to shed that you say, oh my goodness, you know, I was taught that in school and I sat there and we did sit there with Josephus Gret, the great manualist of Thomistic philosophy, and other people like that, okay? What I'm saying is there is a tradition in Christianity we can call the mystical wisdom tradition, okay? And now that's in resurgence, okay? Everybody wants to, you know, it starts way back right in the scriptures with even the Old Testament, the wisdom literature, and it goes boom right up, and we can follow this fantastic tradition of wisdom. But there is also a theological wisdom, okay? A wisdom of theological reflection, and there also is a metaphysical wisdom that the Catholic faith possesses and has nurtured for centuries. Well, what happened? That is, in my mind, as critical as recovering the mystical traditions of the church if we are going to understand Zen. Because when our friend here, Bunan, says, the moon's the same old moon, the flowers exactly as they were, yet I've become the thingness of all the things I see. Is he talking like John of the Cross? Is he saying something that John of the Cross is saying, like, lost to myself I stayed, my face upon my lover having laid, from all endeavor ceasing, and all my cares releasing, threw them amongst the lilies there to fade. See, what are we doing? In a kind of general sense, Zen is very mystical, okay? I'm not denying that. But let's listen to Bunan when he says that, and we have to say, wow, to me, I say, wait a minute, that doesn't sound like the same kind of thing to me. Maybe I don't understand Bunan, and maybe I don't understand John of the Cross. That's certainly possible. But then I say, what else is in my tradition? And what is in my tradition is the metaphysical wisdom of Thomas Aquinas, okay? Now, this metaphysical wisdom is not something like Plato and Aristotle kind of quick over baptized. That Greek wisdom came into the church, that Greek philosophical wisdom. In, for example, Plato, I mean, everybody thinks of Thomas Aquinas in relation to Aristotle, because Aristotle was just being made known during those times when Thomas was teaching. Yes, Aristotle, but also there's a great Platonic element and many other elements went into Thomas. But when they reached Thomas, they received a transformation. Thomas was not just a tremendous philosopher and tremendous metaphysician, But he was also a great theologian and a mystic. And so within that context, he had amazing depths of metaphysical insight. And we're going to have to talk about this. And like I said, I don't think it's going to be an easy thing to talk about because our past is terrible. We've been victims of bad pedagogy. We've been destroyed in the schools because someone told us, here it is, and they read us some things, and we're on some hot afternoon in the classroom listening to some kind of syllogism, and we're kind of nodding off, and they're saying, oh, you have to take this course in metaphysics, and we're just worried about passing a test and get out of there. Too bad, because they murdered something really good. And the reason it happened was because it's like anything else you institutionalize. Okay, let me give you a little thumbnail sketch of the history involved. It'll only take a minute. Sort of like, here's Thomas. He has these insights. He didn't hide them. He wrote them down in his Sumer and everywhere else. But they're such like little gems that you can read Thomas and read these words, and unless you, they're almost like some of Joshua's koans. They're so kind of little lapidary phrases. And unless we get the insight that Thomas had, we don't get it. We say, oh, I read blah, 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 blah. You know, there it is, so it's simple. Oh yeah, Thomas said this about the ways to demonstrate God's existence, well, but you know, we know better than that now. We're enlightened, modern people. No, we don't understand Thomas, because to understand Thomas is to understand that it's going down in the depths and it's having a metaphysical experience. And out of that metaphysical experience is born Thomas's metaphysical words. And without the experience, the words are just empty words. All right, so Thomas has this insight. Well, even the people of his own time, a lot of them didn't get it. You can almost say most of them didn't get it. And though they got pieces of it. And so it travels on. So we're talking, Thomas dies in, I think it's 1274 or something like that. Anyway, it travels on and we get into like the 16th century. And in Spain, there's a man called Domingo Báñez. And he happened to be, at one time, the spiritual director of Teresa of Avila. But besides that, he was also a fantastic metaphysician and Thomist. And so he saw it. And one time he must have been exasperated because he says, well, Thomas says this so clearly, but Thomists don't see it. And then he tries to explain what Thomas was seeing. Okay? But, you know, it's hard. It's hard work. It's sort of like saying, well, what's this moo or what's this cypress tree? I mean, it's something you can work on conceptually, but if you do it just conceptually, it's never going to hang together. Anyway, so then time goes on, and there's other people like John of St. Thomas, one of Thomas's great commentators. I think he's in the 17th century. Finally, we get to modern times. Pope Leo XIII and sees that there's a revival starting in Italy with Thomism, and he says, okay, we need this because what we have as Christian philosophy is all a mishmash of this and that, and these pieces we've taken from modern philosophy, and some of it is not even compatible with Christianity. So let's get back to Thomas. And this tremendous revival starts. And in some ways, it was a very brilliant revival. And it had a lot of stars of the first magnitude in it, but it got institutionalized. And so once you institutionalize something, then you need all these teachers of philosophy, and you send them, and they read the Summa, and they get a little letters after their name, and they go and teach seminary students. It wasn't alive. Sometimes it was, lots of times it wasn't, okay? Anybody who went through it, well, they can vote on whether it was alive or not, okay? So we have all this Thomism supposedly going on in the church, and it goes on, and people are forced to do it, and you're supposed to be a good Thomist and know all the Thomistic theses and memorize them, and, well, real life doesn't work like that. Finally, the time in the Vatican Council, the lid comes off, the pot boils over, everybody wants to get away from this kind of stuff because it's been killing them for years, and so they did. And so you can, Thomas disappears, Thomism disappears, and we sort of back into one of those eras, like many years in the past, where there is no Thomism. Well, there is some, and in fact, we could talk about that, but it's not really on the point that in certain places Thomism stayed alive, and in certain places it's coming to life, and so forth. But as a general thing, we could say, right now, Thomas does not excite us. And so when I say, okay, we're going to talk about Thomas Aquinas and Zen Buddhism, you say, oh my God, because here's this dynamic Zen Buddhism spreading all around America, and thousands of people are interested, and who wants to hear about some dry old philosophy, okay? So we gotta overcome that, because otherwise, we don't know our own tradition. And if we don't know our own tradition, we don't know how to talk to Zen. So that's half the problem. The other half is the problem of Christian mysticism, okay? It looks different. We say, okay, we really know our Christian mystical tradition, but I think what we really should say is we want to know it, we're enthusiastic about it, we want to practice it, but we still have to learn it. There's a lot still to learn for all of us in that tradition. And by that I mean, the last time, I think I mentioned this at one point, the last time that people were enthusiastic about mysticism, Christian mysticism, was 300 years ago, okay? And they got enthusiastic because principally, one of the major factors was because of Teresa of Avila and John of the Cross. Their influence spread across all these kind of boundaries within the church and influenced many other currents of spirituality. And their writings and the spread of the Carmelite order and then the input of these other orders set off this real surge of interest in mysticism, in the interior life, in praying, in practicing contemplative prayer all over Europe during the 17th century. And what happened? It ended in such a smash at the end that Catholics couldn't go near their mystical tradition in any practical sense. They sort of had to be closet mystics for 300 years. That's how bad it was, okay? Why did this happen? This is a question that is somewhat intricate but important for us, because if we think that we know John of the Cross, we have to make sure we really know him. Otherwise, we can be talking about John of the Cross and mean something else, okay? For example, John of the Cross, he died in 1591, 400 years ago this year, And his works were not printed until the year 1618. And in that time, all sorts of things were happening. The world wasn't just kind of waiting on John of the Cross's writings to appear. His manuscripts were circulating around in monasteries, and people were already talking about what his writings meant before he was published, okay? And I think you can make a good case that some of the things they said about these writings were not quite right. And some of the things they said stuck pretty good. And some of the issues that in the old days were known as acquired contemplation are things that people said about John's writings that we really have to take a careful look at. Is there such a thing? Oh, everybody talks about it. If you look at the kind of tradition, you can say, well, here I can give you 10 manuals of mystical theology, and they're all going to give us a discussion on this. And there's some people who claim there is no such thing. No such thing, okay? And they claim that you cannot find such a thing in the writings of John of the Cross, okay? And fighting words, maybe, for some people, and we'd have to understand what it all meant, and that's something that we can unscramble a little bit tomorrow. Okay, I'm going to pause, and we'll do one question or two, and stop. The point is this. I'm saying, yes, let's understand Zen. Try to understand it from the inside, I'm saying, but let's understand our mystical tradition and our metaphysical tradition, and then maybe we have a hope to try to put them together. We have four things to do today, okay? We want to take a better look at Zen itself, Zen experience. We want to look at Christian mystical experience. We want to look at metaphysical experience. And then the fourth thing is we want to say, what can we say about Zen enlightenment from a Christian point of view? Okay, so each one of these things could take us forever, but we're going to touch on each one. But I don't want to become so programmed here that we can't kind of deal with any issues that you have as we go along, because that's the whole point of the exercise. So we're going to be, again, asking for questions and comments, and let's just do it that way. Okay, so Zen, that's where we're starting now. And, you know, sometimes we get the impression from reading Zen writings that they talk about nothingness, or they talk about the void. And you know, there's been an impression in the West for quite a while that somehow Zen is nihilistic, like they're heading towards extinction, and that's where they're going. But that's not true at all. Zen isn't heading towards extinction, towards pure nothingness in the sense that we understand it, because why would these men and women sort of seized by pain and suffering, just like we are, trying to find the meaning of existence, why would they just want to become extinct? They could go kill themselves if they wanted to be extinct. They are looking for the meaning of life, and I believe that they must have found something terribly exciting and important to sustain them spiritually for these thousands of years. Any other way of looking at it seems to me that we're reducing them to something that is a caricature, because we wouldn't do that. We, you know, just extinction, okay? So their nothingness, their void, has to be something else. I'm going to read you a passage by a Chinese Zen master. Forget exactly when he lived, I think 6th or 7th century. His name was Wang Po. Okay, he died in 850. Okay, here's what he says. When your glance falls upon a grain of dust, what you see is identical with all the vast world systems, with their great rivers and mighty hills. To gaze upon a drop of water is to behold the nature of all the waters of the universe. Moreover, in thus contemplating the totality of phenomena, you are contemplating the totality of mind. All these phenomena are intrinsically void, and yet this mind with which they are identical is no mere nothingness. By this I mean that it does exist, but in a way too marvelous for us to comprehend. It is an existence which is no existence, a non-existence which is nevertheless existence. So this true void does in some marvelous way exist. All right, so I could, we have to see that we're dealing with not a theory, but a living spiritual practice. And so I want you to listen to someone who has trod this spiritual path. We're gonna have a little visit with Susan Postel.
Been a difficult student throughout my history of spiritual practice because Glassman very generously offered me koan study fairly early on in the early years, and I said no. I was always skeptical of things, and I also had been doing 10 years of all this chanting and mantras and visualizations, and I just wanted to sit. So for a long time, my official practice was what we call shikantaza, which is just sitting. And I sat a lot. I had children at home, two kids, and I was newly separated and then divorced and working full time and not able to run off and enter the monastery, which is, I think, what I wanted to do at that point and devote my life to this practice. I was really struggling with the balance between my responsibilities as a mother and needing to work, but I sat a lot. I sat at home. I was in the Zendo several times a week in the evenings and on the weekends, and found myself more and more feeling as though I wanted to give my whole life to this practice, that this was what was the most important thing. And what began to shift in those early years as a Zen student was that kind of where my priorities were. I think in the years when I was involved in the Tibetan Buddhism, it was a little more of an added thing onto my life. And now it was my life. There was no more sense that there was some My involvement with Zen was not something I did like a yoga class or a hobby, that I did to feel relaxed or something. It was my life. And what was arising inside was an almost driving aspiration to break through and be somehow not bound by this self which I began to know so well. And so there, in those early years, was this Looking back now, it was a kind of a rising, burning, a flame kind of thing that just wouldn't out, wouldn't go away, but rather seemed to increase, of really aspiring to awaken and to really do it and to not be content or be able to rest. It was not anymore coming from some idea that there was such a thing as waking up, but really coming from sufficient experience to know that it was possible. I think what happens is, you know, the self is like this box that we have these concepts about I, and as we sit, there's holes that are punched quite literally in that box, and it's like we see the light that's really there, that's everywhere. And then we use this word enlightenment, but it's for a reason. And our experience of what's beyond the walls of self is very bright and very vast. And so first there's these holes punched, but once a hole is punched, we know for ourselves that there's something else besides just this wall. And our whole stance towards practice changes. When it's just theoretical and we read that there's something beyond, we're in one place. But the minute we've actually sort of seeing light through holes, our relationship not only to the light but to the walls is very different, because we know they're punchable. You know, they're, and we also have a sense that they get thinner and thinner and thinner. And so it's like the emptiness of the walls becomes known to us very personally and experientially, not theoretically, not conceptually. So I think during those years, that's what was happening. There was some pretty powerful hole punching happening. And I was talking about oatmeal stuck in bowls. I discovered we have this tendency, you know, to put a gilded frame around the hole. I mean, that's how we attach, you know, it's like the medicine bottle. So we get this hole and then we gild it and we decorate it. Oh, look at this, you know, and it's wonderful. But we decorate it. So again, so much of practice in those stages was getting rid of all the extra stuff, including this kind of gilding of the frame around the hole in the wall that's really not there, you know. And so that kind of process was happening. And I think Sensei certainly saw this aspiration as genuine and was very encouraging and very supportive. At one point, he no longer asked me if I wanted to do some koan work, but insisted. I think the way he put it was something like, now it's time to get rid of the sutures. And I said, what are the sutures? And he said, well, that's for you to find out. And I went home and I thought, you know, when you have an operation, when it's all over, you don't need the stitches anymore. They're unnecessary, they're extra. And so what was the extra threads that were tying me that I didn't need? They didn't have to be there. So he very much at that stage wanted me to work with the koan mu. Some of you perhaps know a little bit about this sort of koan work. It's a question which can't be answered with the conceptual mind. And if one works on a koan, one is asked to bring one's entire being into becoming the question. So in this case, a monk asked Joshu, good old Joshu, he keeps appearing. It's wonderful. Wonderful teacher, Joshu. A monk asks Joshu, does a dog have Buddha nature? And Joshu answers, moo, which means no, or it's a negative particle. Sounds like a cow, you know. And so a student is asked to become that sound, that moo. And in fully becoming the sound, allowing the entire universe to break open, where there's no gap between subject, object, between I and everything. And essentially, mu becomes the cosmos. And skeptical Sue, of course, raised her head once again. As we're talking, I see these threads that run very true. And I said, oh no, I don't want to do this. And I really didn't want to do it. I thought, how silly. I don't need this. I've had all these wonderful gilded experiences already. Notice the gilding as I speak. I mean, I thought they were pretty good. I've had these experiences. Usually Mu is used as an opening koan. I've had my openings. What is this, you know? And I didn't want to do it. And the more I didn't want to do it, the more I heard my wise teacher sort of nodding and saying, you let me know, you know, when we're ready to start, and you're going to do this, and of course you're going to do this, and it's time. And some little, and it was very little part of me, knew that he was absolutely right, and knew that if I could finally break through skeptical Sue and all she brought with her, that there was a degree of freedom possible that I simply didn't have now. And so some little part of me said, you know what, you're going to have to do this. I will honestly say that it was extremely difficult time. My resistance was very, very strong. And what arose was, I guess, my attachment to being a good Zen student. I thought I didn't need this, and to have to let go of what I thought of my practice. And I thought I was, I know, I have all kinds of pictures of what I was, a kind of very subtle, I guess, a kind of arrogance and pride, and all of that had to go. And if we've got some pride, that's very hard to melt, because there's reasons for the pride and we justify it. So I found myself encountering the self, you know, which is exactly what it's supposed to do. And I would go up for interview, and what happens often is you have to sound this moo out loud with your teacher. And I was far away from my voice. I was out here, and my voice would tentatively say a little moo. Not like that. I mean, I try to do it full voice, but I wasn't there. I was somewhere else. I was self-conscious. I was critical. I was skeptical. I was all these other things, and I certainly wasn't manifesting as the sound of moo. And it was very painful, because sensei would ring his bell, and I finally decided I was hopeless, and I really hit a real bottom and thought I was just no good at this. And it was all, I was just a failure. And I don't know about everyone else, but I'm real hard on myself. And, you know, I was all, then I would be critical of myself because I was a failure, and there was this layers and layers and layers of negative stuff, self-directed, self-inflicted, self-created. I just laid it on to the point where I just is gonna just forget it, you know. But I didn't forget it, you know. I kept sitting, and this, again, there was this tiny voice that said, that's what you're supposed to be seeing, idiot. You're supposed to encounter. This is the self operating. You know, this is your resistance. You know, this is up against the wall, just real tight. And I squirmed, and I didn't like it. It was almost like the, you know, the pin and the butterfly kind of feeling that it had gotten me now, and I knew it. But the little part that knew it was very little, but there was that kind of, I don't know, what's the word? Little bit of intuition that knew this was exactly what I needed. So it took altogether about 9 months. It was like a gestation. And I guess we started in January, and I would say it took till about July when something began to shift. And those early months, that whole winter and early spring, I was a total failure as far as I was concerned. But I was still sitting, and I was sitting with Mu, and I would take my seat and to myself silently, because my children, they already thought I was weird enough. I'm going to start sounding like a cow, you know. These poor kids, they lived through this time. Anyway, I would go upstairs and sit in my room where I had a little altar and everything, and the minute I began to sit, my exhalation became a silent moo. And the whole time I'd breathe out was this moo. And I just, my effort at that point was to be that breathing out of that sound. And I remember, I guess it was around June or July, where I went up again every week to go see my teacher. And he heard that I wasn't so far away from that sound. Something had shifted completely. And I remember his saying, oh. And I didn't even know at that point that there'd been this coming, this where Susan somewhere was being able to be one with the sound of Mu. I didn't know that. And I remember his sort of welcoming and saying, now we move. And then the next few months, July, August, September, those next 3 months were a very different process. No longer blackness, no longer I'm no good, but a loosening was happening, and everything was just loosening. And I would sit, and it was, you know, I would cry and shake sometimes, and it was embarrassing, but I couldn't help it. But essentially what began to happen was I can only use an analogy. It felt like the house of cards on which Skeptical Sue and the whole structure was built, as though the bottom card started to go. And what I experienced those last 3 months was this kind of slow crumbling of the whole edifice once the bottom cards went. Like something in me just gave up in the resisting. And once that had gone clunk, then the whole thing had to go. And it took its own, it had its own life, the dropping. It wasn't all of a sudden everything in 1 minute. But I began to experience that, oh my goodness, everything. And each time I would sit, I would feel this dissolution. So it was a good 9 months. And the last three, a little scary. But in the end, tremendously joy-filled. The strange part being that it seemed like no big deal at all. And it seemed as though I was where I've always been. And it seemed so funny that it had been so difficult to get there. And it really is funny, you know, you just, how weird us humans are, that we have to go through such a trip to stand on the feet we've always been standing.
That's Zen, okay? That's Zen. And we really have to keep that in mind when we're gonna get off into more theoretical things later on, talking about how we can understand Zen and all these things. But if we lose sight of the fact that that is Zen, then we're gonna lose it somewhere along the line, and it won't be a dialogue anymore. So whatever it is that Susan is talking about there, it's not nothingness in the sense of nothing or nihilism, or it's some tremendous spiritual experience. Okay. Now, let's go on to our next point. But first I want to say, all right, questions and comments. This is a sense of what Zen is. So let's talk about that a little. Any questions and comments you have about that? Yes. Okay, we should go on now. Let's talk about Christian contemplation. Because a lot of the questions, the word contemplation is coming up already. is what Susan is talking about the same thing as John and the Cross talking about? Is it? I don't think it is. Okay, so I'm going to confuse everything now and make more problems, because I don't think it is. Remember the poem we're reading from The Dark Knight? John of the Cross, he wrote his poems first, then he wrote his commentaries. The poems are what kind of burst out of him after the experience. John, as most of you know, was born in a little town in Castile in Spain in 1542, and he grew up there, a little poor little kid, and joined the Carmelites, and then was one of the first members of Teresa's reform when it started, and the reform got pretty hot and heavy there, and they took John and they threw him in a dungeon in Toledo. It was the Carmelite house. I mean, they threw him in a closed-in room in the house to punish him because he wouldn't renounce the reform. They were fighting over all sorts of technicalities and stuff. And it was while he was in that dungeon while he was being abused by his fellow monks, and he underwent this, what he would later, I think, call the dark night of the spirit. And it's out of that kind of personal suffering that his first major poems were born, like the Spiritual Canticle and the Dark Night. Now, we really have to try to understand a little bit about John of the Cross and about, you know, I'm using him, like I said, I like him and I know more about him, but we could do this with a lot of figures in the Catholic mystical tradition, because I think they're one family, okay? They're one family. But what is Catholic mysticism about? What is Christian mysticism about? Is it about what Susan's talking about? It isn't, because for one reason, you can't make mystical experience happen. Or put it this way, Teresa and John are very clear when they say, you know, you can certainly prepare yourself and you ought to be preparing yourself, but you can't cause in what they call infused contemplation to take place. Okay, that sounds like a pretty complicated term, but it's really not that complicated, okay? Infused contemplation means that, to sort of understand that, we have to understand a little bit of the way John of the Cross understands the spiritual life. And so first he talks about meditation. Now, what he meant by meditation is not always what we mean by meditation, where, you know, we have a very orderly, the old picture of you make the considerations and you see the pictures and you come to the... He meant something wider than that by meditation. He meant anything we do ourselves, each time we use the intellect and the will and the imagination and the senses. That's what he meant by meditation. Sometimes he calls it the natural working of the faculties, okay? We work, okay? We pray. That's meditation. And so his idea of meditation embraces a lot of things that today are considered sort of separate, like more affective type of praying, or more practicing of the presence of God, or more kinds of active recollection, or going in with ourselves and trying to be close to God. Now, certainly we could call these things contemplative in the wide sense, but I want to use the word contemplation like John of the Cross uses it. So bear with me there. So we'll make that distinction. There are many different ways contemplation is being used, and I'm not saying they're wrong. It's not my point. My point is that I want to use the word in a more specific way, the way Teresa of Avila and John of the Cross used it, okay? So they're saying anything we can do, the prayers we pray, that's meditation, okay? And when we start the spiritual life, oftentimes we pray, it feels like God is responding. This has come up in the course of the week. It's sort of like this sense of sensible consolation. Wow, this is great. I'm praying, God's responding. And we're getting this, you know, this sweet, John the Cross calls it the sweet spiritual water. Every time we want to drink, it's there, we drink it. And that's wonderful, because before we were attached, all our working of the faculties was attached to the world, and we got to get out of there, so God takes us where we are, and he makes spiritual things sweet to us, so we leave the world, and we go like this, and we say, oh wow, this is better, and we start drinking in all this good spirit, you know, sweet water, and, you know, oh, this is great. But, and we say, this is God. That's where we go wrong, okay? We say, this spiritual water is the same thing as God. But really, God, to communicate with us, is coming through our natural faculties, okay? Coming through these channels we have of our mind and will and emotions and senses and imagination. He's using them. But because he uses them, he can only communicate part of himself because the channel is too narrow for him to get through. So he does what he can because of where we are, and we say, wow, this is God, and God's saying, this is kid stuff, okay? So John of the Cross says, well, it's like, you know, the baby is being carried around and nursing at the breast whenever they want. That's the beginning of the spiritual life for many people, okay? Well, then the day comes when the mother takes the baby and says, that's it, no more, start walking. And we can't handle that, okay? That is bad news, because we've identified our spiritual feelings and aspirations, this kind of sense, with God. And it is our way of contacting God, but we've identified it too much with God himself. So God says, wow, you know, this person won't grow if they don't learn about faith. As if this is, you know, mature faith, so I'm going to put him down. And then we cry, because we say, God has abandoned us. This is what John of the Cross calls the dark night of sense. He says, when the sun of divine presence, you know, seems to be shining the brightest, sometimes it happens very suddenly, not always, but it seems to be shining down on us, and then we turn around and it's gone. And we say, my God, what did we do? What did I do to deserve this? What sin have I committed? What real crime have I committed that God has left me and now I don't have him and I'm just, okay, that's the dark night of sense. All right, you know, most of us have been on this journey long enough to know lots about those kinds of things, up and down and everything. Now, what we want to get to is the next part, okay? What happens? Now, this is tricky, because John of the Cross was a real mystic, real contemplative, and he saw it this way, this kind of schema I'm outlining. But that doesn't mean that we all go that way. That doesn't mean there aren't a lot of other ways to go that are our particular ways. I don't know that there are a lot of people who go by the way John of the Cross describes, okay? I think there's a lot of other ways, and you see them in the saints. Question of Saint Therese has come up and stuff. People who are really holy, because the essence of holiness is really not contemplation, it's charity. And contemplation is like a overflowing of charity into the mind, okay? The contemplative experience, we'll talk about that a little more. But it doesn't mean all of us are supposed to go by the way John of the Cross describes. I think we have a universal vocation that we're headed to the beatific vision and seeing God. But in this life, we all have our road to travel. And I'd be reluctant to say that if we're not contemplatives like John of the Cross describes in his books, then somehow we've messed up. You know, we can get into that later if you want, but I don't want you to get the wrong impression that I'm saying that this is the way, okay? I'm just using it as a way to contrast it to what we've been seeing about Zen. Okay, there's the dark night of sense, and we go through that and we learn to try to go by faith. That's one way. But what John is talking about is a little different. He's saying, if we go in that night of sense, for some of us, it's because we're being called to contemplation. Okay? He says, what's happening is that God is taking us away from this using of the faculties and introducing us to a passive and infused union with himself. And that's what John of the Cross and Teresa are all about, this passive and infused union with God. Now, this union is not the same as us wanting to be with God, us in faith placing ourselves and living in the sight of God. It's us experiencing within ourselves our union with God. Okay? It's an experience. It's not an experience that is here, okay? Contemplation doesn't happen here. It happens somewhere else in the depths of the soul. They say in the heart, or you could say in the center of the soul. It doesn't come through what we do, okay? Now, let's imagine there's some poor soul who's been, you know, getting all these consolations. All of a sudden, the lights go out, the sugar's taken away, and God begins to try to come from behind, all right? Not the usual channels we're used to, but he's sort of trying to come up through the middle. And the guy says, God's gone, I have to go get him, and he starts using the old machinery again. I have to meditate, I have to make all these acts, and I have to get all these feelings going. And all the time, God is trying to get to him in the middle with this new kind of experience, okay? He's trying to get to him and give him this new kind of union, this new kind of deeper experience. I read your passage of John of the Cross about some of these things, so you get a sense. At this time, God does not communicate himself through the senses as he did before, by means of discursive analysis and synthesis of ideas, but begins to communicate himself through pure spirit by an act of simple contemplation in which there is no discursive succession of thought. Now, this simple contemplation is not some act we're doing. It's sort of an act that is being done to us, okay? We don't say we're going to be contemplatives in John of the Cross's sense. God gives us that gift. And let's go on from... all right, so we have the dark night of sense and there's contemplation, the light at the end of the tunnel. But it's a long tunnel and a confusing one because first, almost all of us enter into some kind of dark night of sense. Can't pray like we did before, it just doesn't work, okay? And the consolation disappears. That happens, and it doesn't often take a long time before, after we really start practicing the life of prayer until that happens. But that night of sense, that is a common experience, this night of sense in the wide sense is not the same as the night of sense that leads to this contemplation of John. If it was, he could have just said, you go in the night of sense and then you come out to contemplation. But he doesn't say that. He says, how are we going to know if we are called to contemplation from the night of sense? You know, if the night of sense was automatically contemplation, he wouldn't need to give his famous three signs to discern whether what's going on. Okay? He wouldn't need to give those three signs he does because it would just be automatic. All right. What are the three signs? Let's take a look at them. All right. First sign. We can't meditate like we used to do. Okay? That's his first sign. The second sign is we don't really want to get involved in all sorts of other things either. Okay, and the first two signs really mean this. Our first way of praying is disappearing, but it's not happening because we're turning our back on our spiritual practices. It's happening because I mean, that's the point of the second sign, is to make sure it isn't because we're just becoming lukewarm, okay, and we just don't want to make the effort. So that's why he puts in the second sign, you know, that we don't desire to go running out to nightclubs every night to get away from our time of prayer. Because if we do that, then we got to wonder whether we're being serious enough. But if we can say that we honestly want to pray as much as we wanted to pray before, and now we can't do it the same way, all right, we got the first two signs. And the first two signs are very common. Now we get to the third sign, okay? Now this is the most important sign, and there's a lot of confusion about what it means. The third and surest sign is that a person likes to remain alone in loving awareness of God without particular considerations in interior peace and quiet and repose, and without the acts and exercises, at least discursive, those in which one progresses from point to point, of the intellect, memory, and will, and that he prefers to remain only in the general loving awareness and knowledge we mentioned, without any particular knowledge or understanding. All right, what does that mean? You know, that we're talking about remain alone in loving awareness of God. Well, John is very clear and subtle when he starts talking about this transition from meditation to contemplation. He says, well, because the experience is so different and we're so used to pounding away with the faculties and making so much noise, that God could begin to give us this experience of union with himself in the center of the soul, this kind of union of whole with whole rather than broken up into pieces, and we wouldn't even notice it because we're too busy, okay? And so he says, well, you know, that's a problem. You have to watch that because it's such a delicate thing at the beginning. It may even be intermittent that if you pound away, you could miss it. Okay? Well, that's one of the things he's saying. But when he's saying this kind of loving awareness, this interior kind of quiet, he is not saying some kind of loving awareness that we generate. Okay, I am going to, I mean, we have our own forms of kind of interior recollection where we lovingly attend to God. Okay, that's not what he's saying, though. He's saying God is lovingly attending to us and beginning to make us experience a certain interior union with himself. Okay, and what he's talking about is no different than what Teresa of Avila talks about, and she will distinguish between kind of like a active recollection that we can do, this going in with ourselves and being with God, from a passive recollection where we're beginning to be more led by God. And then it comes to the question of what she calls the prayer of quiet, like the formal beginning of the mystical life, which is really the same thing John is talking about here. It's really Teresa's prayer acquired and the things that lead up to it. Now, I'm going to just read you a couple more things of the way John describes these are different ways in which John describes this prayer. He says it's one act that is general and pure. This peace and rest of interior quiet. It's a loving and general knowledge of God. It's substantial and loving quiet. It's confused and general knowledge. It's general and loving attentiveness or knowledge of God. General and supernatural knowledge and light. Pure and serene light. Pure and simple general light. It's quietness and ease. Contemplation is naught else than a secret, peaceful, and loving infusion from God. Okay. Now, it's true that contemplation, there's real issues about how perceptible contemplation becomes and all these things, and you can talk to people who seem to be contemplatives and they can tell you a lot about how dark the road is that contemplatives travel, okay? And how many trials there are on it. It's no path of roses to be a contemplative because this is just the tiny beginning. But the point I'm trying to make is that contemplation in this sense is an experiential sense of union with God. Part of the problem with understanding what John is saying now is that after John wrote his books, everybody wanted to be a contemplative, okay? Teresa was more responsible than John because her books came out earlier and circulated everywhere. Everybody wanted to be a contemplative. And so, and this included the members of the Carmelite orders, and since they wanted to be contemplatives, they read John and they see, fantastic, I want to be a contemplative, it's my vocation, I belong to a contemplative order, so I better be contemplative. And they tried to be contemplatives, okay? But what do you do if you're not, okay? I think there's a lot more people who are not contemplatives than are, in the sense of John of the Cross. What do you do if you're not? Well, what happened, the short story, we'll get into it if somebody's interested, but the short version of the story is, they read John of the Cross, they read some of these passages, and they said, really, John of the Cross is talking about two, you know, there's Teresa talking about infused prayer. But John of the Cross is talking about a kind of contemplation we can do ourselves. But that's not really what John of the Cross was talking about. Okay, so that's where you get into a whole problem about acquired or active contemplation, and as if there were two parallel contemplative paths that we can go on that get to the same spot. I mean, this, I'm trying to, this is my idea of what John of the Cross is saying, I think. Okay? Questions? Yeah. And I think that that something is what John of the Cross is calling faith. Faith is something we can walk by, okay, whether we're contemplatives or not. And even if we are contemplatives, sometimes the people who have great contemplative experiences suffer a great deal afterwards because they get put down on the ground and have to go by faith as well. And they were flying so high that it's very difficult for them to do it. But we can go by faith, and we have to go by faith, whether we get sensible consolations or not, whether we get infused mystical graces or not. We have faith, and we have charity, and we have hope, and those are the things that unite us to God. And that's what we can do all the time. And we have to continue praying, even though we don't know how to do it. You know, we say, oh my God, the consolations are gone, and it's so dark, and I don't know where God is. You have to continue, okay? Because in faith, we are resting in God. That's what faith is, and it's so dark to the natural personality that it looks like it's kind of blindness. And John of the Cross talks about that all the time, how dark faith is to our intellect and will. He's talking kind of in an experiential sense, how dark it is. And we have to go by that darkness. Now, the point about this active contemplation is certainly we believe that God is in that darkness and we try to rest in him and unite ourselves to him. But the problem with a quiet contemplation is where we say, oh, I somehow, without experiencing it, I am in union, I am experiencing God. It's a paradox, it's a contradiction, really. We read John of the Cross and say, well, I'm experiencing what John of the Cross says, but I don't experience it. Let's not worry about that. We don't have to experience it like he talks. Faith is the way to go. And we can always do that. And if God wants to call us to infused mystical graces, he can do that. He takes people sort of by the hair of the head sometimes and does it. So if we're relating to him in faith and in love and in this fidelity to our interior life, we're doing our part. He can take us if he wants us that way. And sometimes people picture John of the Cross being off somewhere in this dark night and on some journey where the practice of the faith in the sacramental way and the consideration of dogma and all these things sort of just fell away as if they were like little shells. He was never like that. He was extremely faithful to his own kind of external practice and to the teaching of the church. He was very concerned about that. And he would, you know, even write some of his poetry about the Blessed Sacrament and things like that, and about the various beliefs of the faith. So there's no disjunction there, okay? Yes. But what I'd like to do now is to try to get a sense of what this kind of contemplative experience is like. Because even if we're not called to it, still it's part of our own sort of heritage, and we should be aware of it in case, you know, we have to deal with it somehow sometime, either in ourselves or in others. Now, what we're going to see, we're going to meet somebody who God just sort of took a hold of and gave him some tastes, touches of this contemplative experience as if to get him started on the road, okay, to get him started on the road, because maybe there was hardly any other way to do it. He didn't have any other way to find his way to God. So God had to take some pretty drastic means to do it, as we'll see. Okay, so once we do some of that, then we'll try to go on to our third thing, which is what metaphysical experience is like. And then finally, we're going to try to put everything together.
So I joined the Air Force for 4 years. It was an easy thing to do, being young and foolish. I was driving a friend of mine's car, which was a big old heavy Packard. And I was driving down a road in California that was a two-lane road. It was an old road, it was concrete. And it had just started to rain. And the first rain in California on an old road like that is slippery, because there's oil and dust on the road. It's, you know, it's starting to mix with the water. But I didn't know that at the time, and I didn't know that the rear tires on the car were bald. They were balonies. And I was driving, speed limit then was 55, and I was driving about that speed, and I stepped on the gas to pass, and I wasn't driving recklessly or anything, but as I turned back into my lane, the car began to go sideways down the road. Now, it went completely sideways, and I tried to correct for it and took my foot off the gas, but it was like on ice. And I'm sliding down the road like this sideways, 60 miles an hour, and sliding gradually off the road towards a huge tree. And I can see this tree coming up for me, you know, like I say, closing speed of 60 miles an hour. And I see it, it's gonna hit me right where I'm sitting. So I laid down in the seat. I was calm enough, and I just laid down in the seat, and just before impact. And the car sure enough did hit, folded in the car where I was sitting, hit me on the rump, broke some bones in my lower backs and vertebrae, crushed them. So now I'm in the hospital recuperating, and after a couple of days they need to set the put a cast, half body cast, to keep my spine straight while it heals. Some friends from the base came, and the master sergeant brought his girlfriend, who brought me some books to read. Now, I don't know if he told her that I was reading all these strange books about hypnosis and mysterious type of things and scientific things or what. I don't know why she brought me these books, but they were rather unusual books. One was the book written by a Hindu priest, not a Christian priest, a Hindu, of the Hindu religion. And he wrote the story of his life and the story of his coming to America. But the most striking thing about that book, or about the example of that man, was his trust in a living God who was the one true God. And he was a God of love. And this priest trusted this God so completely, it was like he had a personal relationship with him, and he trusted him to take care of him even in miraculous ways if necessary. As I read this book, for some reason I was awed by the possibility of God, a living God who was a God of love, the one true God. And since he was a God of love, he was willing, because of love, to use his power to help anybody who would love him in return and trust him. And the more I read this book, the more I was overwhelmed, really. I could say convinced. I was getting more convinced, but I was overwhelmed with this possibility of a God of love. You'd think I would have known that God exists and that God is a God of love because I was born and raised a Christian. Went to church every Sunday with my folks as a child and as a young teenager. But I don't remember ever knowing this, you know, or believing it. But as I read this book, I was becoming convinced and enamored by this God, and at some point while reading it, I began to make personal acts of trust and belief, faith in this same God. And as I did so, it was not an experience of where I'm just a human being making interior acts. As I did so, it was a living experience that happened where I would trust this God in all, and He was there, and He would support that trust, like encouraging me with something that was more than just human, but it was so integrated to my humanity that I didn't stop and say, something is happening to me, something mystical, something extraordinary. I just started believing in this God, and it was exciting, and it was real. And the more I believed, the more I wanted to believe and trust. It was as though the act of believing was also an act of love and worship. But anyway, that's sort of looking back on it. At the moment, I was just starting to believe, and as I believed, I was entering into the reality of this God of love who, since He was God, had infinite power. And since He was a God of love, He was willing to use this power to help us, as He helped this priest, who was not even a Christian. I guess I sensed that he would help me or anybody who would love him. And I was very much aware that since he was a God of love, that's all he wanted was love. How did I know it? I don't know how I know it. It just was inside of me. And it was like a reciprocal thing. The more I would believe, the more, the deeper it would happen. And I began to want to do this every moment. I guess you could say it was like I was making contact with God, this God, but I didn't stop and say that at that time. At the first few days, I just wanted to keep reading that book. It was quite a thick book, so it took a few days. But at the end of it, I didn't go back into the book as though I needed to go back and get something from it. At the end of the book, I was ready to close the book, but I wanted to do this believing in God and being aware of Him. And in that process, I was like entering into Him, even though I was staying on the earth in the hospital bed. In my consciousness and awareness, I was like somehow entering deeper into God. I wasn't going up or away or anything, but in an interior way, I was getting closer to God, and I began to want to just continue this motion of believing and loving. I didn't call it loving then, but it was like giving and trusting. That was everything. I wanted to keep doing this every moment, and I began not to want to even talk to my roommate, who was very talkative, young person, and I didn't want to read anything more. I didn't want to sleep anymore. I didn't want to eat. I didn't want to do anything anymore, but just continue this, I guess nowadays you would call it a dialogue. In this act of believing, I was giving my heart and my mind to this living God, whose name I did not know other than He was the only one true living God. He was a God of love. and he was honest, he was truthful. I was giving my heart to him in trust, in belief, and he was giving himself back to strengthen that or affirm that is true, that act is true, it's acceptable and it's true. And it was a reciprocal, ongoing thing. That's how I would describe it. It was reciprocal. It wasn't just me making acts, you know, as I think most humans conceive of the acts of religion that we make. We just make them, but we never get anything back. There's no conscious, experiential reciprocity. But and that was not, that was a, what I'm, what I went through at that time was a living experience, so exciting.
They're both really intensely on a journey, but the sort of character of the journey is so different. For Susan, it's you, the house of cards falls, okay, and then you become illuminated by this reality you find, okay? Which the Buddhists have their own distinctive terminology, the void. The Tibetans will say even the pure and immaculate void, okay? For Joseph, it's always God. It isn't like he has to wonder whether this is a person that he is in touch with. There's no doubt in his mind. Not because he has lots of preconceptions about the experience, because he didn't. He just, you know, he didn't know, so he didn't have to frame it in those ways, but you see him struggling and kind of reinventing mystical words, and at the beginning he's sort of doing it because he's in contact with the person of God. That's how he looked at it. That's how he's trying to say it. If Susan was in contact with God in that way, then I don't know that she could avoid saying it. You see what I mean? Before we get, well, I got to remember to tell you about Susan later anyway. Okay, so for myself, I see them both going on this inner journey, but they're different kinds of journeys, and they're both heading towards some sort of absolute. And I don't want to say that there's different kinds of absolutes. I don't. There is, from our point of view, from a Christian point of view, I don't want to say that. I'd rather say that there's different aspects of the absolute that you can contact, okay? And now we're going to have to hunt a little harder, because the next part is the part where we're talking about the metaphysics of St. Thomas, and everybody's going to kind of cringe. Now I could, but I'm not going to, have our little visit with the metaphysician of St. Thomas, but because there are a few left, and but I will tell you about one. Okay, now, metaphysics of St. Thomas is not complicated. I'm gonna turn this a little more so you can all see it. Anyway, it's not complicated, but it's so simple that we don't get it, okay? It's one of those things, it's like many spiritual things, that it's not because it's some big intricate thing like, you know, some theory about nuclear physics, but it's because it's so simple that we miss it. All right? A lot of the most important things in life are like that. So we're going to get the quick course in the metaphysics of St. Thomas, all right?
Okay. Let's say we're standing here at point A. Now, standing here at point A, this is the universe here, between these two lines. This is all creation between these two lines, and these are the different individual creatures, trees and birds and butterflies, and whatever you want, stars. When we stand here, we look at the universe and we see distinctions. Okay, we say, well, there is a tree, and there is a man, and there is a carrot. And if I said to you, well, there's really no difference between the carrot and you, you'd be upset because you might think you're being insulted, okay? And in a very real sense, there is a difference, okay? I am not a carrot. I am me, and you are you, and you are not a stone. These are different things, okay? And we see the world like that. So the world is made up of different things. And so you can say that they have a certain, this kind of difference, the face of difference turned toward us. And the philosophers used to call that essence, sort of what a thing is, okay? So we could say we see the face, the different essences. This is a tree, and this is a stone, and on around the circle. Okay, that's sort of everyday consciousness. Now, with Aristotle, what a thing was, the essence, was sort of like the highest principle of it. If you could sort of define it, you had sort of were grasping the highest principle that made it what it is. Okay? But when we get to Thomas revolutionized metaphysics, because for him, essence, what a thing is, was not the highest principle. He was enamored with existence. Now, let's say we can look at this thing from the point of view that we say what it is, but we also can take another fundamental way of looking at it and say it is. We can sort of focus on the fact that it exists. Okay? We can focus on the fact that it is a being. Okay? And if we do that, if this is the line of essence, in here, we can say the tree exists, the stone exists, the man exists, okay? All of these things exist, and because they exist, they have this profound bond with one another. Let's put it this way. What makes, let's say tree-ness is what makes a tree to be a tree. Let's say it has the essence of a tree, okay? And that's what makes it to be a tree. And so on around the circle. But if we try to ask ourselves a very strange question, and we try to ask ourselves, and this is what Thomas did, he said, what is the ultimate nature of essences? What makes a what be a what? You get that? So what makes a what be a what? In other words, there's some profound bond between all these different things, and it's the fact that they all exist. They don't all exist in the same way, but they all exist. Okay, and it's as if each one of these things is a particular capacity for existence. One's like this, and one has this kind of capacity, and one has this kind of capacity. And essence means nothing more than a certain capacity for existence, okay? There is no essence like it's floating around waiting for God to fill it up, okay? Because then it would already exist in some way. It doesn't exist at all. All it does, it's a capacity or a potential for existence. Well, Thomas saw that. And he saw that if each one of these things is a certain kind of capacity for existence, let's say we even can give them numbers, okay? Here's different kinds of capacities for existence. The different capacities are what makes them different. They have a different kind of capacity, but they're still all being filled by existence. And the existence fills them as far as it can, depending on the capacity. And so they exist with a certain kind of existence. It's sort of like, if you want to be a little crude about it, you have the big vessel, the big glass, and we pour in the existence and it takes the shape of the glass, okay? Takes the shape of the glass, and so we have a limited kind of existence there, but it's limited because it can only fill what's the space that's available. All right, we're gonna go one more step, and then we know all about Thomas's metaphysics. If we could really see this, I'm talking about it, but I mean if we could sort of see it, it's sort of like a natural kind of metaphysical kind of contemplation. Okay, you can be a natural contemplative, a philosophical contemplative, and look at these things and get very excited, all right? And here's the next step. If each one of these is a certain capacity for existence, then each one of these only has a limited kind of existence, okay? One's this big and one's this big, but they're all limited kinds of existence. But can limited kinds of existence be a sufficient reason for their own existence? In other words, these things receive existence, okay? They're getting it because it's sort of like they're being filled up. They have a certain little capacity and it's being filled up. But then you have to say, well, what is existence in itself? Suppose it wasn't received. It had to come from somewhere. It's like the thimble isn't responsible, and the glass is not responsible for the whole picture. There has to be the water source. The water has to come somewhere. There has to be the ocean. And so Thomas says, these limited capacities for existence that we see around us point to the fact there must be something, someone who is not an essence receiving existence, but is existence itself. Okay? And so he says, everything here, here's let's call this the essence side. Here's the existence side where it's received by the essence. Everything here, if we really could see into its depths, points beyond itself. Okay? Everything here points beyond itself. and it points to something or someone, to existence itself. Because if there were no center, there could be no circumference. If there were no unlimited existence, there could not be limited existence. And we know that limited existence exists because we're it. And we know how limited we are. But there couldn't be limited things without an unlimited thing. That's what he's saying. Now, the words are there, but to penetrate into it, you need to have metaphysical experience, just like you would have a religious experience, okay? Now, we'll get back to this in a second, but Thomas, when he says this, he's not saying, I can reason and then I see existence. He doesn't say that. He's saying, I know because of the way, the very intimate structure of reality, that this center must exist, but I don't see it. All I can do is reason from this to this. It's sort of like, you know, you sort of say, well, something's holding up that chair, kind of thing, you know? There is something under it, otherwise it'll fall apart, it'll collapse. Well, that's what Thomas is saying. He's saying, if these are the rays, there must be a sun, but I don't see the sun. You don't see God through metaphysics, okay? You don't have a vision of God in metaphysics, but you can know God must exist. And this point gets,
Thomas's proofs for the existence of God, so-called proofs, what he called ways, are just a tradition in the church. He didn't invent them. You know, you can even find remarks in St. Paul that way. That's what he's talking about. He says the very creation, if you want to put it other way, is manifest. If you really look at it, there has to be some reason, some, put it in metaphysical terms, existence itself has to be in the center, okay? So that's it. Now you know all about Thomas's metaphysics. There's no more to it. And we just have to meditate for 20 or 30 years or so on it, and that'd be it. Okay, now the problem is that words are never enough, and especially true when it's a question of metaphysics. So we lost it. Okay? Because we went into the classroom and, you know, tell the kids about Thomas Aquinas, and the kids go, oh, you know. It wasn't alive. It wasn't real. Okay? And let me give you some idea of how metaphysics really starts in actual reality. Okay? Doesn't start in the classroom. Here's a story that someone recounted, and it goes like this. Early one morning, when I was busy making breakfast, the sun came over the horizon, and its first rays streamed through a window and struck a red cup sitting on the kitchen table. I had seen that cup hundreds of times before. I had washed it, put it away, drunk from it, and let my fingers get warm around it. But until that morning, I had never truly seen it. The sun seemed to illuminate the cup from within. Okay? There's lots of concrete ways we can approach towards metaphysical insight, and then you need that flash of lightning that leads to the actual insight, which is the metaphysical insight. And his wife, Raisa, had some experiences before their conversion to Catholicism that helped them on the way both to metaphysics and to Catholicism. Here's one one of Raisa's. She was in a car passing through a forest. I was looking out the window and thinking of nothing in particular. Suddenly, a great change took place in me, as if from the perceptions of the senses, I had passed over to an entirely inward perception. The passing trees had become much larger than themselves. They assumed a dimension prodigious for its depth. The whole forest seemed to speak of another, became a forest of symbols, and seemed to have no other function than to signify the Creator. Okay, that's another kind of metaphysical experience. Now, that's sort of like, from that experience, the lightning can flash, and you can see what Thomas means when he says existence, or esse in Latin, to be. What does it mean to be? And we take it for granted, because we're all busy about the fact of the ego, like we've heard so much about this week, and we say, I did this, and I will go here, and I will be this. But the most profound thing we can say is, I am. But what does that am mean? What does it mean to exist? All right, if those things were to become kind of our preoccupation and kind of send shivers up and down our spines, then maybe metaphysics would someday come alive again, see? Because that's what it's about. It's about the meaning of existence. And so in ancient times, it was the queen of the human sciences, okay? And it was, you know, it is very exciting and very important, because without metaphysics, you can't put together the rest of philosophy. Without philosophy, we're leaving our reason behind, and we're not going to have much of a theology, and then we're leaving a good hunk of ourselves behind on this spiritual path, okay? Well, we got through Zen, and with Susan's help, that it was real, okay? And we got through Christian mysticism with Joseph and saying, this is real. Well, now we're at metaphysics, and I'm afraid, you know, I don't want you to go away thinking that this isn't real as well. It's very real, and it's very exciting. I'll tell you one story before we take a break. One of the best metaphysicians in this country is Norris Clark. He's a Jesuit priest, taught for many years at Fordham, and won all over the country. And when you hear him talk, you say, well, okay, you know, philosophy teaches, oh, well, you know. There's a difference. And the difference comes because somehow it's alive for him. So we had the fun one time to interview him. And then once you talk to him, you understand why he's so excited about metaphysics. He tells a story that when he was a teenager, he lived around New York City, and he used to like to go to high places. You know, he'd get up high, climb in trees, climb up the pillars that go up to the George Washington Bridge. You know, that's high. He loved that. And so one day, I imagine, he didn't say this, but I imagine he kept on pushing his luck too, you know, get higher and higher. Anyway, on the other side of the Hudson River from New York is the Palisades. Big, giant cliffs, I think a couple hundred feet high, but they are big. So one day he decides he's going to climb the Palisades. And he climbs and he climbs, and pretty soon he's maybe, you know, 100 or more feet off the ground, and he has 20 or 30 more feet, and he's gone up there, and he's really you know, no belts, no hooks, just he just kind of got into it and started climbing. And he runs out of handholds. He can't go up, okay? There's no more, just a flat sheet of rock. And he starts to go like this to get down, and he realizes he can't get down. Because, you know, sometimes when you climb over something, you can't, unless you have the right handhold, reverse yourself to get back over a little ledge or whatever it was. So there he is, you know, 100 feet up on the side of the cliff, and he is stuck. People start gathering, you know, people pull up, and their crowd's getting there, and they see this guy just hanging onto the side of the cliff up there. They didn't know what was going on. And then the cops came, and they get out the bullhorns, and they're, you know, come down here, you know, and we're gonna come and get you. And he's still a teenager, and he says, oh my God, I'll be arrested, and my parents will be disgraced, and I can't do this. And so he does a very crazy thing. He had one handhold going over to his right, and he says, well, I can swing over to my right, but there's a projection of rock there, so I can't see what's over there, and when I swing over, I don't know if there's anything there. Okay, but if I could swing over and there's something there, I can see I could make my way to the top. Okay? Now, for me, I think I'd let the cops get me. But but you know how teenagers are, so. He does it. He swings out, and as he swings out, he gets what he calls a taste of existence, okay? A taste of existence. And like he said, he's there to tell the story. There was a place he could stand, and he got up there before the cops got up there, and he beat it. But when he swung out, he knew something about existence. And that's the reason I think that he is such a fine metaphysician, because he knew the difference between existing and not existing. He knew what a rich and vibrant thing existence was. It's just not a word or a name. It's everything, okay? Okay, let's take a break. We should really take a stab now of trying to put all this together, okay? Trying to figure out our original question about contemplation and Zen. And we've taken sort of a roundabout route, but that's kind of, can't help that. Because the only way we can do it is once we know the principal partners, then we can have them dialogue with each other. But without knowing that, we're not going to get that far. Okay. Here's how I try to explain it. I don't think that Zen is the same as contemplation, okay? Using that word the way we're talking about it today. I'm not saying by that there could not be Zen people who are receiving from God-infused contemplation along with their Zen practice. That could very well be happening, okay? But I'm saying Zen as Zen practice is not aiming at union with God, okay? The Zen people, as much as they say that enlightenment is a gift, they also are very aware that you have to work and work and work to get it. okay? I don't think we would ever have a sesshin, one of these intensive Zen retreats, to arrive at infused contemplation, okay? It would go against the grain of what we believe about infused contemplation to think that if we pushed ourselves hard enough for that week, we could arrive at infused contemplation. Okay, we don't do that, and I think that's the reason, because it can't be done that way. Okay, so on the one hand, Zen is not Christian contemplation, and on the other hand, Zen is not the same exact, it's not something where we're using our mind conceptually to leap beyond our mind, which is what St. Thomas is doing here. Okay, Zen is not a philosophy. They don't want to be philosophers. That's not what they're interested in. They may philosophize afterwards on the experience, but that's different from kind of creating a metaphysics. They don't want a metaphysics like we have Thomas here. In metaphysics, we're using the mind to go beyond, using the conceptual mind to sort of go beyond and take that leap and say, God must be in that darkness. It's not the same kind of darkness. You know, each one of these three things has its own kind of darkness. And so they may look identical, but they're not, because metaphysics has its darkness because once you know that God must exist in that center, fine, that's a kind of knowledge, but it's a knowledge that they used to call analogical. I mean, it's a knowledge that is sort of, because this is, I know it's there, but I don't see it, okay? That's what they mean when they say, you hear people talking about Thomas Aquinas and the knowledge of God, and they turn it into almost like a atheism, like Thomas is saying we can't know anything about God. No, he's not saying that. He's saying this, which is something very different. So Thomas, if he was saying that we just can't know about God, he wouldn't have gone and written this whole treatise on the attributes that natural reason can apply to God, like that he is good and that he is true and so forth. He wouldn't have done that. What he's saying is God as existence so transcends these little essences that it's like the owl looking at the sun. This is even just on the natural metaphysical level. So he says, sure, there must be a God, but don't expect that our little concepts grab him. They just sort of point to him and they give us some weak, imperfect knowledge, but very important knowledge that God exists. Okay? And I think that's, it's sort of like, it is part of the whole Catholic tradition that we can arrive at God's existence through reason. And I think the problems reside not in what Thomas is saying, but in our weakness in penetrating what he's saying enough to get to this intuition of being and so it'll be convincing. Okay. So I don't think that Zen is interested in creating a metaphysics. It's not a metaphysics itself, except after the fact, okay? Because Zen really is about some kind of experience, okay? Metaphysics is, in metaphysics we don't experience God. That's the point I'm trying to make. We don't have any contact with him, okay? In Christian mysticism, we have this interpersonal contact. Now, I'm going to put Zen in the middle, and I'm going to say that it's kind of a mystical metaphysics or a metaphysical mysticism. I'll explain what I mean by that. We cannot by our own natural striving, know God in his inwardness, okay? Know God as Trinity, know God as this community of persons. That's where the whole distinction between nature and grace comes in, okay? We can have a natural knowledge of God, but that natural knowledge of God is different than the knowledge of God that comes through revelation, the knowledge of God that comes through faith, okay? Because the knowledge that God that comes through faith is a knowledge about it's a knowledge about the inwardness of God. So we're going to have to, you know, work on our pictures here. Let's see, left my pen somewhere. Ah, there we go. Okay. Let's get rid of this one now. All right. Let's try to make three circles. Squeeze them in there. Okay. Now, over here, here's our metaphysical circle we just had with the everything points to the center, okay? But the center is not something we can contact, grasp, see. Otherwise, we'd have the beatific vision, okay? If you could get a hold of God and see God, seeing God is no different than having the beatific vision and seeing God as Trinity, okay? If you see God, that's what he's like, okay? All we can do in metaphysics is point and say, I am convinced there is a center, but I don't contact it, and we thirst for contact, okay? We don't want to just do this, and that's one of the reasons why metaphysics suffers, because we say, oh, okay, even if you can do that, and exciting as it is, where's this contact with God? All right, now over here, let's call this one over here Christian mysticism, and in this one, it's sort of like the center appears as a person, okay? The center appears as a person, and the contemplative has some kind of contact, not perfect, but some kind of taste or touch with that center. That center, if this is the soul, it's God appears in the center of the soul, and there's an intersubjective union, okay? Not a union like we'd have with an object, where I'd say, well, I'm here, I'm the subject, and there's God, and he's the object, because then that wouldn't be a very satisfying one. It's one where I'm inside myself, I'm the subject, I'm in me, and I know me in a special way, okay? My knowledge of myself, my sort of self-conscious knowledge of myself is sort of our own inwardness, all right? And so we're in our inwardness, and we're looking out at other people, and they're out there, and I'm in here, okay? Well, when God comes in this kind of contemplative way, he doesn't approach us as an object. He gets in the middle of our own subjectivity like a deeper subject. Make any sense? It comes in that way, and that's why you can't get him with concepts. That's the whole problem if you keep on working with the natural mind, kind of shooting out all these ideas, because it's a hole coming inside our little hole, you know, with a W. It's like the whole thing, it's the whole subject of God, not an object, not knowledge about God. It's that living presence of God that Joseph was trying to tell us about. Okay, so you could say that, we'll read
draw this picture a little bit, if this is God appearing in the center of the soul, then and this is sort of like our own subjectivity, then this kind of, the two subjectivities are experiencing, you're sort of experiencing the other person from within rather than from without.
That's the only way I can put it, the way I'm understanding John of the Cross. It's like, if you love someone so much that you, instead of being outside them all the time, you could sort of get inside them where they are looking out. You see, you got in there and you're spirit to spirit. John of the Cross is talking about something like that. But this time, God is transforming us into himself. That's the whole point of what John the Cross is talking about. So that we are becoming God. Certainly not by our nature, like our being, because we're just limited creatures, but by being transformed in knowledge and love. Okay? We are directed towards God as, because he is where our knowledge and love is going. So there is this tremendous mystery of transformation that we hear about all the time in kind of dogmatic terms, and John of the Cross is trying to say that in the Christian life you actually experience this becoming God. Okay? That's the only way you can put it. And that's how he puts it. Participation in God's nature. Okay, so that's the thing. So now we're leaving Zen right in the middle there, because Zen Zen is not either one. Okay. You don't get to contact with God by this kind of contact that comes from Christian mysticism. You don't arrive there by technique, okay? No matter how elevated and spiritual the technique is of controlling the mind or controlling the breath or concentrating, you can't arrive at God's inner nature that way. Why? Because it's like there's such a difference between the level of our being and the level of God's being, okay? The only way you can arrive there is not because it's due to us, okay? That would make us God by nature. And we know enough about ourselves to see that that's not true. The only way you arrive is through God's gift and through the transformation that comes through knowledge and love, you know, transformation that comes in grace and so forth. The whole Christian mystery revolves around that kind of distinction. So what I'm saying then is Zen is not Christian mysticism in that sense. It doesn't sound like it to me. And when I read it, you'd have to really force it. And someone like Suzuki, he was aware of that difference, that it's not the same kind of thing. The Zen person doesn't go around praying and thinking about God and trying to be transformed into God. He doesn't do it. Okay. Now, at the same time, the Zen person will say certain things that are really very interesting. Now here's the story. One of these is a comment where this lady is, I think she's studying with the Koan Mu, and she gets awakened. She goes to the Roshi who's saying, "Yes, you got it." And the Roshi says, "Now you understand that seeing Mu is seeing God." Why would the Roshi say that? He's not a Christian. He doesn't care about thinking of God as some kind of, you know, God he would pray to. That's not, it's foreign to him. So why would he say it that way? That's a clue, okay? Another clue is that let's imagine that we're born in, you know, 7th century China, and we never heard of Christianity. And we have this thirst for meaning and the thirst for the absolute, and it's no different than their thirst then was no different than our thirst now, and it's a thirst for God, we would say. Thirst for God, okay? But since there's no revelation, then how do we articulate this? Okay, how can we articulate what we call this search for God? Well, I think that at times that the Zen person was forced to turn within, to look at the human subject and try to go down as deep as possible inside that human subject to find the most ultimate reality that could be found by plunging into the depths of the human subject. And that means kind of putting away all these thoughts and concepts and all that kind of stuff, okay? Because that's too much out here. And go against the grain, plunge into those depths, and try to find the ultimate depth you can get to by sheer heroic human effort, the ultimate absolute you can arrive at that way. Now, in all this, I want to make it clear that I'm not saying that they are any less involved in a world of grace than we are, because God is everywhere. I'm trying to focus on their techniques, that distinctive Zen journey, okay? All right. Let me try to finally say what I've been getting at here. What happens? It's as if to say that in the center of every soul, in the deepest part of our being, is that place where we come into existence, okay? God doesn't just create our soul and then kind of give it a little final touch and say, okay, off the assembly line, next one. He sustains everything that exists in existence at every moment. Okay, that's been always the traditional teaching. And so somewhere in the depths of our self, okay, in the depths of our soul, there's a point where we touch God. God touches us. Has to, because he's keeping us there. All right? There's some center point. Now, I'm not saying that, we're not talking about this kind of thing, where God sort of makes his presence felt in the center of the soul through grace and through this sharing of his own life, okay? Again, I'm not denying that Zen people can experience that, and they probably do, okay? But when we're talking about Zen as Zen, if this is the human soul, we spend our time looking out, okay? And we spend our time kind of on the superficial levels with all our ideas, okay? We don't even see the things around us clearly because all our ideas are getting in the way and we're looking out through them. And okay, now the Zen person, my estimation, tries to quiet all this, but there's layers and layers of it, okay?
layers and layers of what you could say are kind of the all our ideas and thoughts and emotions and everything else, and they start going down through these layers. Okay? Now,
the whole Zen journey, if you ever get, you know, sort of, it has its own kind of phenomenology, you know, how it happens, what goes on, and sometimes they experience things that are like Philip's Kundalini, okay? Other times they experience visions and revelations. And all the time, the Zen master keeps on saying, no, don't stop there, keep on going down, because you have to get to the bottom. All right, now I'm gonna see if I can find something where it will give you, okay, the Roshi says to his student, yes, you will realize your true nature only after your mind has become as empty of thoughts as a sheet of pure white paper is free of blemishes. It is simply a matter of engrossing yourself in mu so totally that there is no room for thoughts of any kind, including mu itself. In other words, let's attach ourselves to this koan mu and get away from all this stuff and use that kind of the way to quiet the mind and reach a certain kind of stillness. All right. So you can't do Zen and keep on thinking about it, okay? You can't be kind of trying to do no mind and keep your conceptual mind working. So what happens is that if you practice long enough and hard enough, like Susan was explaining, that house of cards is all these different layers, and they begin to collapse, and they're no longer operative in the same way, and you get down, and finally, when all the collapse goes on, all these conceptual cards have fallen, you experience what is at the center. Okay, now, what's at the center? What is at the center? You see? Yeah, existence, say it.
Existence.
Okay, what's at the center is existence. And what does that mean? It's sort of like at the very center is the point where God, as the author of existence, is touching the soul and bringing it into existence. If we could get back to that point, dig down far enough, we'd no longer have any ideas, okay, what this is, what that, all the what's fall away, and we get back to that, simply that. But the that is that very point where God is infusing existence into the soul. Or put it another way, that very center point is the existence of the soul inasmuch as it's springing forth from the hand of God. Okay. There's profound analogies between what happens in that state and what happens in the mystical state, okay? But there's not an identity. In other words, it's the same kind of process, I mean, the same kind of, you lose the ego and you arrive at some absolute, and that is certainly an absolute, okay? But you're not arriving at an experience of God as person where you enter into the person of God and are transformed that way. Because you can't do that without knowing it it's happening to you, okay? It's sort of like Joseph couldn't talk like that if he thought that, if he didn't think that God wasn't present to him, you see? What's happening here is God is present by his power and by his creative power. So it is, you're actually contacting God, but you're not contacting God in the way that the mystic contacts God by grace. You're contacting God as he is the author of being. What's happening here is not the same as what's happening in the metaphysics there, where you know the center is there. You are experiencing the center. You could say, it would be fair to say that you are having a natural mystical experience of God. It'd be fair to say that, yes.
How could God not give the same thing that God gives in Christian mystical experience? How could God be different?
He's not, it's the same God. Okay, yeah.
How can you touch just a little bit of God?
Now, it isn't like you're touching a little bit of God, okay? Let me try to explain it better. All right. Now, this is the point we have to get straight, okay? The Buddhists are just as holy as anybody else because the way we conceive of God is that everybody is called to share in that life, and it's going to happen in all sorts of ways, but we're all on, from our Christian point of view, we don't want to sound imperialistic about it, but we're saying that the Buddhist is destined for the vision of God just as much as we are, okay? And so, it's not the Buddhist's fault that, you know, he was born before the time of Christ. God is there drawing everyone to himself in the depths of their being, okay? And so I think that in the depths of the Zen Buddhists practicing, giving their life for their practice, God is operative, all right? And I think he's operative by grace. And I also think that grace can permeate this whole experience. But what I'm saying is I want to distinguish between the experiences in order to bring them together. So what I'm saying is that I think it's possible to have an experience of, you're right, if you ever touch God, it's going to be the God of the Trinity, okay? So I'll make that clearer for you. What I think is happening is this. Now this whole theory, I'm not going to take the credit for because I'm not smart enough to think it up. And I'll tell you where it came from in a second. Okay. Let's imagine here's the soul and here's God, okay? And to be crude about it, it's sort of like here's the existence of the soul, okay? So what's happening is that we're going down, 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 and we hit here. We don't hit God directly and immediately. We sort of hit him immediately through the existence of the soul. But this existence of the soul has been purified of all concepts and ideas. And so it's sort of like, picture if you can, the existence where, you know, where we're the very point where we're coming into existence, and that point becomes luminous because it's so close to God. It's not like we can somehow touch God because, like you're indicating, would have to be an experience of grace because then God would be manifest. But it's like he's trans-illuminating the very foundation of the soul, which is its own existence. Okay, well,
so would the difference be in what we're asking for and expecting?
Uh, I think the difference is that there are different ways of trying to reach God, okay? There are different journeys towards what we're calling God. And as I said before, the Buddhist part of it, the Buddhist journey, I'm sure is permeated with grace. And I can't imagine that some of those people, like the lady over there was talking about, have to be a lot more put together than we are, even on a level of grace, but they don't know grace as grace, which is our gift, okay? But they know things that we don't know that could very much enrich us, because we don't know that much about the self. Let me read a couple of passages. And while I read them, try to get a sense of, keep this in mind, and maybe we can make a little more headway that way. Okay, here's the story of Philip Kaplow, for those of you who were around last night, who became an American Zen master, when he actually became enlightened after years of striving in Japan. He walks into the what is going to be his final interview with the master, and hawk-like, the Roshi scrutinized me as I entered his room, walked toward him, and prostrated myself, and sat before him with my mind alert and exhilarated. "The universe is one," he began, each word tearing into my mind like a bullet. "The moon of truth." All at once, the Roshi, the room, every single thing disappeared in a dazzling stream of illumination, and I felt myself bathed in a delicious, unspeakable delight. For a fleeting eternity, I was alone. I alone was. Then the Roshi swam into view. Our eyes met and flowed into each other, and we burst out laughing. "I have it, I know. There is nothing, absolutely nothing. I am everything, and everything is nothing," I exclaimed more to myself than to the Roshi, and got up and walked out. Okay, I'm just going to clarify this a minute. If we give up all concepts in order to enter this night, to try to reach the very bottom of the soul, where the soul is springing into existence. So we're going to experience the very existence of the soul as it comes forth from the hand of God, okay? If we do that, then when we have this experience, the concepts are far, far away from us, okay? And in this one experience, we're experiencing the existence of the soul, we're experiencing God as the author of existence, and we're experiencing existence like that outer circle of the metaphysician, where existence is in everything, okay? But they're all blended, well, not blended, but all bound together, because we achieve this experience engulfed in a night of all concepts. In other words, we put away all our what, and we go down there and it explodes, and what we're getting is these three things together. And that's why, the Zen person can say, there is nothing. What does he mean? This is just nothing? No, not at all. I mean, you don't work that hard for nothing. No thing. There is no more concept. You've reached the what we would call an absolute. They don't even want to do that because they think that's too much of a name, a word, a concept. That's why they don't want to use God, okay? Because they figure if you use words, you're too far away from the experience. And you are far away from their experience if you use words, which is why they hate words. Because they're going through the night of all concepts to experience that. But once they come out of there, they can't distinguish between what we would call the human soul, between God and between all creation. So they will make statements that are intelligible if we keep that in mind, but will be unintelligible if we don't. For example, we'll go back to Joshua and his cypress tree in the garden. If we could see that cypress tree as it sprang forth into existence, we would see it's sort of like as it came forth from the hand of God. Well, imagine if you weren't distinguishing God and the tree. You could say the cypress tree and mean the total meaning of existence, okay? They see it as a tremendous gift, you know. They thank the Buddha and the patriarchs, and they ought to, because to arrive there is such a rare stroke of fortune that it is like a great gift, okay? But it's not in itself transcending the level of nature, okay? That's not putting it down. It's just to try to distinguish it from grace, a grace that may work right in and through it, but in itself, it's not the same experience as the other one. The other half of the story is we don't have what they have, and we lots of times don't have what we're supposed to have. So where are we? So they at least have some experience, and it shows a lot of times, yeah. Well, among the Zen Buddhists, once they say that the cause of so many of our problems is the divisions we see among each other. If you have this experience, you realize that everybody is one, and you drop all these divisions, and you drop all this desire and anger and greed, and that's, you know, as you work at it, it doesn't happen automatically. But if you saw everything as one with you, then you're just not going to get peeved the same way. You know what I'm saying? And the other fact is that they take the vow of the Bodhisattva, which says, I do not want to go on to nirvana, to, you know, the enjoyment of this without saving every being. Okay? And that's a pretty powerful statement. I would imagine they would say there's never an end. And in fact, they have quite elaborate schemas of different levels of enlightenment, and the ox herding pictures, series of 10 pictures, are geared to the different stages of enlightenment to explain those stages. And it's sort of like, it's just the beginning, the first koan mu, and they even have sayings like, well, you know, that person stinks of enlightenment because they got enlightenment, but they haven't kind of actualized it in their personality and in their body and in their daily practice with other people. Okay. I'd say that from a Christian theological perspective, the original state was probably a state of what we're calling contemplation now. It was probably a state of metaphysical knowledge, like we're talking about. Was it a state of Zen-like knowledge? It could be. It could be because that Zen-like state, think about it, imagine using your mind to the utmost to experience God to the utmost. It's really a beautiful thing, okay? And on the other hand, it may be that part of the drive that we experience for redemption among the Zen Buddhists, because these strange terms are strange to them, they have to seek redemption in this way, okay? To do as much as they can. It's like the pearl of great price. Well, that's the pearl they know, and they seek it. And I'm sure, I would imagine God honors that as that it could almost become sacramental for them to do that. I don't see why you can say that. Two problems. One is, Christian wants to have this interpersonal relationship and not this. The ultimate goal for the Christian is this interpersonal relationship, okay? So there's a difference. The other problem is, wait a minute. The other problem is that if you shed all sorts of, you have to shed everything. It's sort of, they talk about the gateless gate. If you go through the doorway that makes you shed all your concepts, it's very hard for you to talk about distinguishing God from the soul, from the created universe. And so they, when they go to reflect on the experience, they reflect on it and they kind of unite these things in a way that we would not unite them. And so if we were to practice Zen and we weren't aware of that, we could sort of go down that, start thinking Zen and then turn around and look at our own Christian heritage and start reinterpreting our Christianity to fit Zen philosophy. And that could create a big problem. Okay, if you remember the David Lois survey and, you know, Christianity is doing Zen but having Christian terminology. See, we don't want to go down that road either. When they talk about emptiness or shunyata, the void, we've already talked about how that's not mere emptiness. It's like Wang Po saying, it's some marvelous existence. We would say that it's, you know, I would say anyway that it's what we're talking about here. That's what that marvelous existence is. But because they have to leave these kinds of distinctions behind to get to the experience, you can't expect them to find the distinctions very readily when they come out of the experience. Okay? The nadir of St. John is, in its ultimate sense, the dark night of St. John comes from contemplation itself. Contemplation is so bright and so powerful that it's like darkness to the soul, okay? That's what John of the Cross says. So that's God's presence coming, okay? And the other one is kind of like a stripping away against the grain of nature, yeah. At a certain point in the journey, he makes it clear of how terrible, I mean, that's why it's such a torment, because you look at yourself in that light and you look like, blah, you know, you're terrible. And so it's very hard to deal with because it exposes the slightest faults and the kind of the, what they used to call concupiscence, you know, the twist in the human personality coming from sin, okay? Finish up by talking a little bit about practice. Sort of like, is it possible to practice both the Christian journey and the Zen journey? Okay. First one point. This whole thing about experiencing the existence of the soul, and through the existence of soul, the soul experiencing God as the author of existence. Like I said before, it's not some idea I dreamed up. I wish I had. But it started when back in late 1920s, early 1930s, Jacques Maritain was reading a book by the Dominican theologian Ambrose Gardiel about Christian mystical experience. And he read that, and as he read it, he got this idea about, started to get this idea about the East, but in what was his mind, it was Hinduism. He wanted to understand Hindu mystical experience, and this gave him a boost. And he went to Father Gardiel to tell him about it, but Father Gardiel didn't quite follow what he was saying. You can see why once you get into this. Anyway, so Jacques Maritain, because he knew people who were deeply interested in India and its mysticism, people like Olivier Lacombe, developed this idea. And eventually he wrote an essay about that, and you can get that essay if you are inclined that direction and see in all its metaphysical rigor how he does this, okay? What we've touched on here. And he was lucky to have people like Olivier Lacombe and Louis Gardet. Lacombe was an Indologist and Gardet was a student of Islam, and both Frenchmen, and they pursued Maritain's ideas along this line and wrote many different books, and finally wrote a book together called L'Expérience de Soi, The Experience of the Self. And they called this, finally called this like a mysticism of the self. Unfortunately, there's their work isn't very well known in the United States, and it's too bad because I think we could make some real headway with some of these issues. I've been trying to do this in relationship to Zen, so you've just seeing that. Zen wasn't, you know, present in the West when they were doing their work, and Maritain was working like it is now. So that was my thing, to do it in relationship to Zen. Okay, now let's get to practice. A while after Susan had her awakening experience, she had another experience where she reconnected with the Christianity of her childhood. She said it was like a reconnection of heart. She had this experience of the heart where she felt this urge to somehow, she puts it sort of like be inserted in the lineage of Christianity. See, she's in the lineage of Zen, like we were exploring the other night. She wanted to be inserted in the lineage of Christianity because it somehow was speaking to her. Okay? And so she has this, she somehow has become a bridge this way. And she's trying to come from that Zen side and discover how she can be a Christian. But it's not going to be an easy task for her because of, to be honest, what the institutional church like, a church is like. If you go to the local Christian denomination, whether it's a Catholic church or something else, and it's the local parish, she can, you know, be kind of put back by, because though I do think that if she could connect with someone like John of the Cross, then maybe it would be different, you know? I'm not knocking what goes on in the parish, but there's too little feeding of the soul as far as the life of prayer. Anyway, so I think that's important because she did this happen to her after that thing you, after that experience she was describing to you, after that initial awakening, okay? Is it possible to be a Zen Buddhist and a Catholic, a Christian, at the same time? Now, we're going to get a variety of answers, but what do you say? Is it possible to be a Zen Buddhist and a Catholic? Say it, somebody say.
Yes.
Okay, now, we got a lot of people are insufficiently sure here, or what? Is it possible to be a Zen Buddhist and a Christian? In other words, can I, in good conscience, as a Catholic, practice Zen Buddhism? Sit and try to reach enlightenment, for example. Can I do that? Yeah, I think I can. And in fact, I do it. So I hope it's okay. But I'm not saying that there aren't a lot of issues, and I think maybe some of the no's are resolving about those issues, because I could be a Catholic who goes along and goes through I'm going on my Christian journey, and I reach that dark night of John of the Cross, and I say, oh, stuck, don't know what to do, so I'll take up Zen. And if I make some headway in Zen, then I'll say, well, Zen is the continuation of the Christian journey. See, I guess that's a possible scenario, okay? Let me run through that again. You know, you start the Christian journey and you get to one of those places where you just gotta go along, drudge. It's possible to, you know, and then so I use Zen, and I get to this enlightenment experience and I say, well, this is the same as Christian mysticism and this is the same as John of the Cross, and then we're kind of getting things mixed up, at least I think we are, okay? But if we could really understand what's going on, we could avoid those problems. But you could say, well, why bother with Zen? We have our Christian life of prayer, right? Why bother with Zen? Who's going to answer that? Who's going to defend Zen here? What good is Zen going to do us? It's sort of like when we're talking about Jung psychology. There's a lot of richnesses in that tradition if we could get to them. For example, how to control the mind, if you want to use the word control, or how to, you know, reduce this constant whirling of conceptual thought. Now we'll get a little further out and say, well, if we could, you know, find the right balance point, could it be possible that, you know, when John of the Cross is talking about Christian contemplative experience and how we keep on pounding away and we're not paying attention because God is kind of becoming present to us. Well, imagine instead of pounding away, we sort of quieted the mind for a while using some kind of Zen in order that this presence could become more manifest. I don't know, that's just a hypothesis. I mean, I haven't worked it out. About. There are devotional aspects to Zen Buddhism, and we can't forget that we're being very selective here today, and there are other forms of Buddhism where they're invoking Amida Buddha, and they're reciting the names, and there's a whole devotional Buddhism, and there's some of that's in Zen, okay? I'd say most of the things that happen in a Zendo like Susan's, where I've sat, are things that don't discomfort me, okay? Because I have my own interpretation All right? And so if they're offering incense to Kuan Yin, that's what was the statue canon, I'm not feeling that they are worshiping Kuan Yin, and they don't worship Kuan Yin, and they're not interested in worshiping Kuan Yin. They're interested in enlightenment. So it's really going to be, you'd have to feel your way. There are other aspects where it would be harder to accept. So I'm not sure. There are some aspects where you'd have to think twice, because you'd want to know, you don't want to be sort of practicing under false appearances when you're making vows to the Bodhisattva or something about the redemption of all beings. Well, what does that mean, you know? You'd really have to think about it. I would, anyway. But I feel comfortable going there and doing Zazen, and I feel welcomed there, you know. And a lot of, there's a number of Catholic or former Catholic people there. Okay, but I'm not saying that I don't have all the answers to that, and those answers will probably emerge slowly as people practice both ways, okay? I'm not particularly afraid of it. I don't know how many people feel inclined to practice both ways, but I think that there's a point here too, that what would happen if a Zen Buddhist, like Susan, let's use her as an example, she did begin to experience this she called this ignition of the heart, okay? These people could or may already be wonderful contemplatives, but sort of deep, secret contemplatives. John of the Cross talks about if the ray of light goes through the window into the room and it encounters no dust, that's all little ideas, you can't see it, okay? I sort of picture some of these Zen people or these Tibetan Buddhists. There's no dust, and so who's to say what rays of divine light are going through there and are not perceptible, and John says, even to the person receiving them. I mean, now we're getting to really things that we don't know, so we're not going to judge what's going on, but I'm saying that it's possible, if it's possible for me to really appreciate and try to practice Zen, Zazen, I think it should be equally possible for a Zen Buddhist to be a Catholic or to be a Christian and not come in conflict with the essence of their Zen practice. The Hindu and Buddhist traditions certainly see themselves very different from each other, but from our distant perspective, I sort of see them as part of the same family, okay? Same spiritual family. And so there are things happening like that, and there's the question of what Bede Griffiths is trying to do, and people like Wayne Teasdale, who are Christian sannyasis, who are practicing the Buddhist and Catholic contemplative paths at the same time. Oh yeah, Hindu and Catholic contemplative paths at the same time. Thomas Merton is another, he was a guy who was pioneering, exploring this bridge. And going out on this bridge, and you wonder where he would have gotten to. From my point of view, it's sort of like, if there's a road that leads to God, why shouldn't we go down it? If God gives it to us, let's go down it, because we certainly need as many roads as we can get, because lots of times we can be doing something and it's so dark and dry and we'd like to really exert some mental muscle or some, you know, oomph. Well, this is not a bad way to do it, instead of going out and, you know. Anyway. I think that, you know, for the Christian, if they're careful to make some of the distinctions, then Zen is enriching. It can really be an enriching experience. On the other hand, if the Christian is sort of, because they're not, you know, because their Zen experience outstrips their Christian experience, if you want to put it that way, then they get to the point where they take Christianity and they reinterpret it in Zen categories. And when you do that, you no longer have Christianity, okay? You have something else, and Christianity is gobbled up. At the same time, when we're doing Zen and we're integrating it in the Christian journey, we have to be careful about the sensibilities of the Zen Buddhist who doesn't see it that way. But on the practical order, I think a lot of these issues can be resolved, you know, because it's a hard one to answer. Susan doesn't have a lot of Buddhist companions having the same kind of ignition of the heart, okay? That's my impression. It was her impression. I think maybe we can answer it a little bit in the sense of what's happening in the Hindu-Christian dialogue in India. There are Christians who are trying to get over the bridge, okay? Sometimes there's more Christians trying to build the bridge that way than Hindus trying to build the bridge this way, and some of the reasons are, one, the kind of experience they had of the British colonialism and Christian British colonialism, so they have that problem. And another is Hinduism's kind of embracing qualities where they'll embrace all sorts of things and incorporate it, okay? So they're not gonna worry too much about another incarnation of God. They got plenty of them, it's not gonna bother them to include Jesus in there too. So it's, in a certain way, you're right. Sort of like practically speaking, what's happening is that we don't have it together, and so our own people leave the church and go looking for some spiritual sustenance because they're not getting it here. And that's true. And so they go to Zen and they find sustenance there. And that happens, I think that's happening a lot. But on a deeper level, we need them, they need us, okay? On a deeper spiritual level, can you imagine what would happen if a Zen Buddhist became a Catholic contemplative and started a Zen Buddhist Catholic contemplative rite in the church? That would be pretty far out, and it would probably do a heck of a lot more for the church in Asia than some of our efforts up until now. Yes. Can you imagine what it would do to Christian spirituality if we understood what the Tibetan Buddhists have experienced for those centuries they sat up in the caves and in the monasteries and spent themselves trying to learn about the human psyche and the void and all these other things. It's sort of like, that's why I see what's happened to Philip as so significant, not for Philip as ego Philip, but because it's a way of saying these realities could come into our own tradition and we would be so wealthy if we understood all these things. It's sort of like taking all the riches we're hearing about and assimilating them in their proper way. And that's just a big chore, but it's certainly a worthwhile one. Okay, now, final point then, more practical level, is that, you know, we're hearing all these things and all these possibilities and all these intuitions, and yet we have to go home and we got to get up in the morning and we got to say, what are we going to do today? And It's like planting seeds, okay? A lot of seeds have been thrown around, and each of us is some particular point on our own individual journey. Let's keep on going, and if one of the seeds starts to sprout, then the week was worth it. So it may be 10 years down the road, you know? I'll remember something that happened, or you'll remember something you heard, and it may be that when we get in a fix, we can turn to something out of Jung, or out of the East, or out of our, new sense of the earth, and be enriched and be able to continue our own Christian journey that way.
Okay. And support.
Okay, this is the end. So we have, I appreciate that you've stuck with it like this. I think that's pretty heroic. Even Thomas Aquinas you stuck with, metaphysics. And I've been very happy to be here with you, and I really wish you well on your own journey. Thanks.